It's Sunny and Finn's Games and Graps podcast. This week, we're joined by special guest Steve to discuss the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view and count down our top 10 wrestling entrance themes.
What's up, guys? Welcome to episode 51 of the Games and Graps podcast. I'm Sunny. With me, as always, is Finn Steele.
Hello.
And joining us once again is Steve.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm good, thanks. You?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Finn, you good?
Perfect.
Perfect.
And glorious.
Wow, glorious. Oh, that's new.
It is.
You're never perfect or glorious. You're barely even good.
I'm
fine. I'm just ill.
Yeah. Well, I was at the hospital earlier today, getting my brain scanned. Sounds a thing. I don't know why it's going out of my head.
Okay.
Sounds fun. And they have confirmed I do, in fact, have a brain, so that's nice.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it's good to know.
I'm happy that that's finally been discovered.
Yes, okay. Yes.
It's a step in the right direction.
It certainly is, yeah.
Yeah.
Good to know. Other than that, yeah, it'd be great.
So the doctors say you're okay?
I'll find out in a couple of weeks.
Okay.
But yeah. No, they'll just come on Saturday, so that's fun.
Right. So just to confirm whether you do or don't have superpowers.
Yeah, I think it is, yeah. I'm pretty sure. Pretty sure that's what they said.
Yeah.
But I'm what kind of superpowers they are as well. Like, I can fly and all that. I'm pretty sure I can fly, but I don't just jump out a window just in case.
Yeah, well, it could go either way, can't it?
Exactly, yeah. It's a risky move.
It is a risky move. don't try it just yet. Just wait until you get it confirmed.
Yeah, I'll wait until it's confirmed.
Steve, are you anywhere close to perfect?
No.
No.
Oh, not either. I'm super tired today.
I'm tired because of children.
Of course.
Being ill. Mm. Bless her. Yeah, and I know I'm going to get a cold. It's going round. Obviously, my daughter's clearly got it. That's why she's ill. People at work are coughing and spluttering. I sat next to someone today for about 4 hours who's got a cold. So,
God, it's always the worst.
I'm going to hammer the Lemsip, other paracetamol-based drinks that are available, at the weekend. So fingers crossed I don't get it next week when I'm out of the country. So,
yeah, it's good then.
So yeah, not perfect.
Yeah, I'm nowhere near perfect either. I'm just tired today. I'm super tired as well. So, I was sitting at my desk earlier on and thought, if I could, I would sleep here. I would just go to sleep right now. And I was just so happy to drag my ass out of the office at 5.
Yeah, it gets like that sometimes, doesn't it?
Doesn't it, just?
Yes.
Yeah, not good.
Finn.
Hello.
What games have you been playing this week?
Well, I finally finished Resident Evil 7.
Ooh!
Which is excellent.
Yeah.
Do we talk spoilers? Can we set it to time to talk spoilers?
We're going to talk spoilers for the next 3 minutes, so if you've not finished Resident Evil 7 yet, or have intentions to play it in the future and don't want to hear spoilers, then tune out now. Steve hasn't really got a choice, but he won't play it anyway because he doesn't like horror games.
Fair play.
Yeah, I might play it. I don't like horror films.
Do you care for spoilers right now?
I'll go for it. I'll probably forget anyway.
Okay.
Yeah. The ending, when you find out who the girl is, I won't spoil, just in case. But that was a cool moment. Injecting it with our stuff, with the serum. Mm. Sort of final boss fight was a bit of a letdown. It gives you all this ammo and all these healing items, and then you barely use any of it.
Yeah,
which is a shame. But it looks very cool. Just cinematically, it looks amazing.
Yeah.
And then when you get rescued at the end by Redfield, who could be Chris Redfield, but looks nothing like him. Maybe just a code name, who knows? Mysterious. I thought that was very cool. And and they did also gonna be a free DLC called Not a Hero coming out in spring sometime.
Which stars said Redfield.
Yes, that's interesting. Look forward to that.
I don't think it's Chris.
No, I don't think so.
Reason being is because there's an animated film coming out.
Yes, that's the same thing.
And it has Chris and Leon in it, and Chris looks like Chris from 5 and 6.
Yep, exactly. So I think it's some sort of code name. Also, it's like Umbrella, and Umbrella's bad guys. It's interesting.
Yeah, but overall, this is a good game. What would you give it out of 10?
I really liked it. I'll probably give it a 9.
Ooh, really?
Yes, 9 out of 10. I would give it a 10, but I thought the final quarter wasn't as good as the first 3 quarters. It kind of became more action-y and gave so much ammo and healing items. So
why I said it's basically an action game?
Yeah, definitely towards the end.
Yeah, because it's just like, here's a machine gun.
Yeah.
Here's more bullets for the machine gun. Go crazy. It's like, okay, well, when I now feel completely invincible now I have these things.
Yeah, seriously.
The monsters don't stand a chance.
Yeah, they're just running up to them with a shotgun, blasting their faces off.
That's it. So, I mean, it is a great game, but There's a couple of things that could be better, but no game's perfect.
No, exactly. I'm looking forward to playing through it again on Madhouse difficulty. I was about to stream, actually. I might stream some of that.
Okay.
That'd be cool. Maybe I'll stream the speedrun. Who knows? I'll stream something.
Okay.
I'm playing that. I've also been playing, also finished Mario Color Splash on the Wii U.
Finally.
Finally. Played that since Christmas. Finally finished it. that was really fun as well. It's a nice little, friendly little game. Nice to strike stuff with when you've been blasting zombies and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So yeah, we've got Wii U still, and you're looking for a nice little simple Mario game. Check it out.
Cool. Or if you, is it not on the 3DS as well?
No, the one on the 3DS is Sticker Star, I believe.
Oh, okay.
That one's not very good. Don't bother with that one.
Fair enough.
Play Color Splash.
Steve, what have you been playing?
Yeah, thanks about it.
So last week I finished Batman Telltale series.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, second time around. I enjoyed it more, actually.
How's that sweet platinum trophy that you've got?
It's great. It's my first ever.
Nice.
I know gamers that have had PS4s, or even PS3s, and don't have platinum trophies.
Wow.
I mean, it's a fairly easy platinum.
Well, it is a super easy platinum, because all you have to do is play through the game, but it's not the point.
Yeah.
It's the point of, that's not your fault that you have that platinum.
No, absolutely, yeah.
That's Sony's fault for giving that platinum away so easily.
Yeah, it's a bit weird.
But, you know, a platinum's a platinum. You've done what the game has asked you to do to get it.
Yeah, this is it, yeah. Yeah, so I've been playing that on the Daydreamer channel.
Yep.
Nice. Doing that as an episodic streaming thing.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah, I enjoyed it I enjoyed it more second time around, I think, because I took the story in a different direction.
Yeah.
So, like, anyone that's watched it will know that I wanted Bruce Wayne to be quite cocky, mm-hmm. be the cocky billionaire, and Batman to be evil, you know, be a bit more, you know.
Still be a good hero, guy. But like...
Be the hero, but do what's necessary to do what you have to be that hero.
Nice.
Yeah, some really cool scenes. The only annoying thing was it crashing multiple times on the stream.
That's a telltale thing.
And that's it was the game. It wasn't YouTube. It wasn't my internet or my PlayStation. It's definitely the game. So, because it did it first time.
Is that thing where it's like there's a problem with the application, then it brings up that bar and it closes it down?
It would just freeze.
Yeah.
And then I would be able to do nothing. I wouldn't be able to go back to the home screen. I wouldn't be able to like even do like a. What I call a hard reset, you know, from the button, from the controller, and then it would come up with error, blah blah blah, and then report problem,
or
retry. So, which is frustrating because most episodes are an hour and 30 minutes at most.
Yeah.
So ideally, if you're streaming that, you want to be able to do that in one stream and have it as one video on YouTube.
Yeah, yeah.
Not have an hour and a half spread out over three parts because it keeps crashing.
Yeah.
So that is the only sticking point with that game. But I would quite happily play through it again and try a different thing. You know, maybe doing something where you only press the circle button or press square or something just to see if it took it in a different... Ultimately, you end up in the same place.
Of course,
you know, it funnels you in, basically, into the same place.
It does, but at the same time, I mean, you got a completely different run through the second time round.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
The first time round.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, obviously, again, spoilers, but if you don't know, Harvey Dent turns into Two-Face by now. You probably shouldn't play the game anyway. But, obviously, the first time you opted to save Selina as opposed to Harvey...
The first time I saved
Harvey.
Harvey, yeah. And he still turns into Two-Face...
But not in appearance.
But not in a physical way, in his mind.
Interesting.
Which still happens anyway. Yeah. But then the second time, when I played it, I saved Selina. The way he becomes Two-Face in a physical aspect is a light falls on his face, burns his face, which looks pretty cool, actually.
It's awesome,
on the game. The only bad thing is the crap mask that he wears.
Yeah, I don't know why he wears that mask. I think it looks stupid.
It looks ridiculous. But, you know, so then he became Two-Face in a physical and a mental one as well.
Awesome.
And there's a bit where you get the choice to either go to Wayne Manor or you get the choice to go to Wayne Corp. Is it to the...
It's
to
the building? Isn't it where you can either go to... Like the
you face
like
Cobblepot.
Ceremony or something like that, isn't there?
Yeah, you either go and confront Cobblepot or you go and confront Harvey. And the second time around, I did it with Harvey. And that scene in the mansion where Alfred's trying to hold them off, that is probably the best scene in the game for me.
Obviously. Yeah, it's awesome.
It's brilliant. It's better than the scene that you do if you choose to go and fight Cobblepot. Mm-hmm. So, really enjoyed it. Playing FIFA, so I'm going to stream FIFA this week onto Daydreamer. And I played a bit of Ratchet at the weekend.
How are you finding Ratchet? What do you think to it?
I enjoy it. I really enjoy it. It's one of the... But I want to keep... I want to, you know, play it consistently.
Yeah.
Rather than do an hour, not touch it for a month, do it. Yeah. Because I'm not... I'm going to just lose the flow then. Yeah. But it's just cool. It's really cool. The graphics are incredible. The
it's insane,
The story's good. It's funny, like I've said before. So, yeah, I really enjoy it. Absolute bargain as well, what I paid for it. So.
Yeah, it's a steal. I mean, it was a steal when it was full price.
Yeah, yeah. And I paid £13 for it in the sale. So,
yeah,
it's ridiculous. You know, and I would... I think you've said it before on the podcast, you know, it's a... You wouldn't begrudge paying £40-50 for it.
No, you wouldn't. No. It's a full retail game.
Yeah, absolutely.
But as a budget game, and it's... They took a risk doing that, and I think it absolutely paid off for Insomniac. So I hope they bring more Ratchet and Clank games out. Just because the film bombed and was supposedly not very good, the game was really superb, so they should carry on with that for sure.
For sure.
There's life in that franchise anyway. I mean, they're a PlayStation mainstay, I would suggest, as far as mascots are concerned.
Yeah.
Is that it? Or is that what you've been playing?
That's pretty much it, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I probably won't be doing much gaming the next week or so.
Fair enough.
Out of the country and all that.
Of course, yeah.
All that stuff.
I've been playing For Honor, which is the new online multiplayer game from Ubisoft. Yes. Basically what it is, you can either pick Samurai, Knight, or
Viking.
And it's basically Faction Wars.
Yeah.
There is a story to it, but not really bothered about it. I'm mainly in it for the online multiplayer. So there's different... ways you can do it. It's like capture the flag mode. You can do 1v1, which is very cool. And it's just a really fun game. And it's one that I hope does really well.
Yeah.
Because like Steep, and I think I mentioned this before, it's something that's very ambitious as far as Ubisoft are concerned. But they are trying to do different things, and I just hope it pays off for them, because it's fine bringing out Assassin's Creed and all that sort of, and Watch Dogs and all these tried and tested franchises, but... When you try something brand new, and it might... I mean, Steep, I don't think paid off at all.
Yeah.
Which is a shame, because it's really good. But this, I think there's life in this. I think people will buy it and play it.
Yeah, people have been very positive about it.
Yeah.
I wasn't the biggest fan. I played it for a little while and thought, it's not for me. But I could definitely see, you know, it taking off and being popular.
Yeah, I mean, me and Denzel played it on the Saturday morning show, and he wasn't sure of it on sort of the first couple of matches.
Yeah.
And then we just started to get really into it, and we started doing really well and figuring out how the fighting works, because it's quite realistic as far as the fighting goes.
Yeah.
Especially with the one-on-one like standoff situations. Like the three styles are very unique. They're not the same in any way at all. And I think it just makes for a very interesting multiplayer game.
Cool.
And I would say it's very, very, it's very much worth looking at.
Yeah.
Sure. Even when it will inevitably drop in price.
Oh, yeah.
So it's worth looking at that point, but I think it's very, very good. Not to be slept on.
Cool.
I've got back into, I've had like a hard drive cull. So I've just got rid of a load of stuff on my hard drive and got the stuff on there now that I want to complete, and then I'll re-download the stuff that I... then want to play after that.
Yeah.
So I've got back into Rise of the Tomb Raider again.
Oh, nice. That's much better.
So I'm going to play through that, and I love it. And I've also been playing Sunset Overdrive on Xbox One.
Nice.
Which I do absolutely adore.
Yeah.
It's just so good. That's Insomniac as well,
I believe. Yeah, it is.
And it's just an open world madness, and it's funny, and it's such a stupid game.
Yeah, I've heard good things about that. Yeah. I don't think it reviewed all that well, but everyone who's played it has told me it's like really good. So
yeah, it's really, really, really good. Yeah. And it's super cheap as well. So if you haven't got it, you can buy it. And it's,
I think it's
free. In fact, you can download it off my profile.
Yeah, I think I've got the download one anyway. Yeah,
yeah, it's very, very cool. And it was awesome. Free, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was free, cold thing.
Yeah, that's definitely worth playing. Other than that, I've been dipping in and out of Pro Evo. I've been playing Pro Evo again, actually. I'm really enjoying it. And
cool. Sport ball?
Yeah. We've been playing a ton of Rocket League. Jesus.
Oh yeah, love Rocket League.
Tons of Rocket League. I mean, I'm three trophies away from the platinum now.
Nice,
awesome.
And I'll get it. All I've got to do is play games.
Yeah, it's just grinding now, isn't it?
Yeah,
pretty much.
Basically, all I've got to finish the season, then win the championship, which I will do.
Yeah,
and then it's literally just playing games until I've unlocked all the items. Yeah. That's all you have to do.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, and then the platinum's mine, and I'll be proud of that one, because I feel like I've actually achieved it.
Yeah, it's cool.
And plus, Rocket League's fucking awesome as well.
Yeah, it is.
It's cool. We've had so much fun streaming it these past couple of Fridays.
Yeah, so good.
The stream was brilliant. I joined it sort of the last half hour, 45 minutes, and I was really laughing.
Oh, good.
It was really making me laugh, and like my wife was saying, "What are you watching? What are you watching?" I was like, it doesn't matter. It's just hilarious. You know, the different, obviously the different people on there, different personalities, yeah. And it just made for something funny to watch. You know,
yeah.
It was,
awesome. I think that's why really people good. Like coming along to our streams because we're relatable, I guess, because we're not. I mean, especially those streams. I mean, the streams we do throughout the week, we're sort of talking about, you know, through the game and stuff like that. But with Rocket League, it was literally random conversations just about nothing at all, about nothing important or relevant or nothing. It's just
dumb jokes every now and then.
Just a fun time. Just a fun time with six guys, and it was really, really cool.
Yeah. It's so cool.
Finn, is there any gaming news this week that you know of?
Honestly, not coming into any off the top of my head. Nothing stuck out this week.
Okay. Well, apparently Activision have said that Destiny 2 is coming this year.
Oh, okay. This year?
Apparently. They're pretty convinced by it.
Interesting.
South Park has been delayed. And it could be any time from April the 1st through to spring next year.
Wow.
So it's going to be at some point during the next financial year.
Yes.
My prediction is we don't see it in 2017 at all. And I think it's spring 2018.
Wow. It's supposed to come out last year, wasn't it?
Yeah.
December. Crazy. November?
Yeah, November. Yeah, December, originally. Yeah. And I think it was December.
Yeah, because I remember the last time I was on the podcast, I was saying that the last season was on Comedy Central was sponsored by the game.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, of course.
So obviously there was supposed to be a link there.
Yeah.
All the games course, out yeah. And there's a new series.
It's like when WWE sponsors WWE on... WWE 2K sponsors WWE on Sky.
Yeah. It's because the game's out.
Because the game's coming out, yeah.
I wonder what could have gone so wrong that it got delayed like an entire year almost.
What the Stick of Truth got delayed forever.
Did it?
Yeah, it just got delayed ages and ages.
Yeah,
and it did eventually come out and it was excellent. So I expect the same from the Fractured But Whole. But I don't expect to see it this year. No way.
Yeah, I know that. I'm a fan of South Park, so I know that Matt Stone, Trey Parker. I know I've got that the wrong way around. Fan of South Park. I know that they are they're almost perfectionists in a way. And I know that they wanted, with the Stick of Truth, they wanted it to be perfect because the PlayStation 1 South Park game was so terrible.
Yeah.
And they hate it. I've seen that in interviews and read that. So it might be a case of that with this. Like you said before, delays aren't always a bad thing, are they? You know, you'd rather a game be delayed but be brilliant when it comes out rather than it come out with bugs and glitches and...
Well, yeah, that's it.
Take note, 2K.
Yeah.
that game gets worse. That game doesn't get better with patches.
I have not played it for forever.
I mean, we played it Sunday and I actually really enjoyed playing it.
Oh, yeah,
but But again, it's much better when we play it together as opposed to when you play it on your own. I played it on my own the day after and I was like, why am I playing this?
Yeah, that's how I've got with it.
But. I was a bit excited after Elimination Chamber. I thought, I'm going to win this championship with Bray Wyatt. Just have a good time with this game. I played one match. I was like, I ain't playing this anymore. It's fine. I mean, I like playing it with Finn, but other than that, no, it's crap. I don't expect to see South Park at all this year. No way.
Shame.
It is a shame, but I mean, it'll come out and it will be great because they won't allow it to be anything great.
Yeah.
But I think it'll be what we're looking at. What we're in now, February. I think March next year. I think it's that far away.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me. Yeah. I mean, I hope we see it sooner, but I wouldn't surprise if we see it.
Yeah, I mean, they must have just got to a point with it where they just weren't happy with what was in front of them.
Because
the game was seemingly coming out in a couple of months, and then all of a sudden it's like, okay, it's not coming out anymore.
Yeah.
It's coming out later on in the year. Now it's not coming out. Well, we don't know when it's coming out, so...
was it E3 that it was first...
Yeah, it was E3 last year, 2016, yeah, so...
Yeah, so, you know...
We found this game-breaking bug that explodes your console. Whoops.
Yeah. Destiny 2 is an interesting one. I mean, obviously, Activision and Bungie would have been working on it for a while, although they seemingly keep working on Destiny because a new patch came out today for it, I think, or yesterday. So Destiny 2 is an interesting one as to whether it will or won't come this year.
Yes. I wonder if you keep your same character from the base game. You don't? Oh.
No.
Well, that's probably a good thing for people like me. He dropped out after a little while.
Yeah, but again, it's easily... You can easily pick it up again.
That's true.
Like, they want the new one to be more accessible to new players as well as experienced players.
Yeah.
But I think it's very accessible anyway. I don't think it's a difficult game to pick up and play.
No, I know the raids are, like, impossible unless you have, like, a...
Oh, raids are hard unless you've got an actual team of people.
Yeah.
But, the story, the strikes, I don't think are particularly difficult.
No.
Because it matchmakes.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I think is what they should have done for raids instead of you making you have a fire team.
Yeah, that is a bit dumb. Because it's like, there's, I remember when I used to do raids, there's a website, literally just matchmakes for you to find people for you.
Yeah.
Someone made. And we were able to go and get through it just fine. But Bungie were like, no, you need a proper team of people, you know. So communicate, yeah.
But it's not as easy as that because not everyone has that sort of network of people.
Exactly,
like,
yeah.
I have Destiny. I don't think I've done one strike.
Yeah.
I love the game, but I don't think I've done one strike because people that I know don't have the game.
Yeah. Maybe you should get together Daydreamers and do some sort of raids or something.
Yeah, I've got it. You will have it because you've got my profile on your PlayStation.
It's not be cheap now, surely.
Well, it has to be cheap. It's in the sale on PSN.
Yeah, I have to get on that.
That's the whole bundle with Rise of Iron.
Yeah, that could be fun to do that on stream.
But it's still so good.
It's patch. It looks really fun.
So, I hope Destiny... I don't think you need Destiny 2 this year. I think they could probably hold it up till next year.
I think so.
And I've got a little feeling that's what might happen because I think if we were going to see Destiny 2 this year, we'd know something proper by now.
Yeah, maybe an E3 demonstration thing. Sure thing.
Maybe.
They
could get it out. I mean, Fallout did it. I mean, Bethesda did it with Fallout 4.
Yeah, very true.
Here's Fallout 4. It's coming out in a couple of months. Sure. They could do that.
Yes.
We'll see.
We'll see. We'll see what happens.
Yeah. And another bit of Activision news is they have basically admitted that Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, despite it being the biggest selling game of 2016...
Right.
Didn't connect with audiences.
Yeah.
It was not
garbage.
I mean, it's not a failure because it was the biggest selling game of 2016. But they think they said they're going to go back to their roots with 2017's Call of Duty.
Cool.
And if they do, World that War means II. World War II, which means it'll be just super fucking popular.
Yeah, probably.
Battlefield did it, and Battlefield 1 is awesome.
Yeah. That's a good move on the Activision part. Wait, who's... EA's part, that's it.
will be a good move on Activision's part to go back to World War II.
I think so.
So don't, if you're a game developer, and for some reason listen to this podcast, don't bring a game out in November or October because the new Call of Duty will blow you out of the water.
Yeah.
If World War II Call of Duty will just smoke your game. It's just a pointless waste of time.
Oh dear. I did play Infinite Warfare. I don't know.
I like it. I like it just fine. But I like Call of Duty. I'm a Call of Duty guy.
That's fine.
And I will buy World War II Call of Duty. Just like I bought Black Ops 3 and 2 and 1. And...
I've done it on my profile.
Exactly. There you go. But yeah, that's pretty much it as far as gaming news goes. It's nothing really substantial. Just a couple of little tidbits that we've dropped into casual conversation there.
Yeah, apparently you can get a cup noodle head for Noctis in Final Fantasy 15.
Sure. Jeez. Is that the Nissin noodles?
So, yeah, sure.
The one that they advertise fairly openly in the game.
Probably.
Nissin Noodles, also the sponsor of Manchester United.
Oh, really?
They're Manchester United's official noodles.
Wow. I did not know that.
Modern United, football.
You learned it the other day.
Oh, there's an official everything for United. It's ridiculous. They got a fucking Russian airline.
Yeah.
Symbol on the car park.
Really?
Yeah, Aeroflot. It's just on the car park.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, it is, isn't it?
Yeah. So you can see if you look for an aerial shot of Old Trafford when there's no cars in the car park, there's a big Aeroflot thing painted
on the car park.
Symbol on the car park.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah. Football.
Hashtag sponsorship.
Yeah.
It certainly is. Speaking of hashtag sponsorship.
Sponsored by Brazzers.
If Nissin Noodles want to come sponsor us. Well, Brazzers. I'll take Brazzers right now.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Who doesn't want to see our faces before watching someone get porked? The Sunny and Finn podcast. Sponsors
Yeah. Like Brazzers.
Awesome.
Good times.
The
good
world's
times.
Best podcast.
Yeah. Good times. Okay. So last week on the podcast, we sort of talked about entrance themes.
Yes.
And we said that this week we were going to talk about our favourite entrance themes.
Mm-hmm.
And I text Steve just the other day. I was like, you're going to come on the podcast? He's like, yeah, okay. I went, right, so we're going to do this thing where we run down our top 10 entrance themes. And he's like, great, this is going to be really hard. And then he comes back to me a couple of days later and he's like, I've got about 40.
Like, yeah.
So we've compiled lists. I don't think we do it round robin style. I think what we do is we each take in turns to run down our list.
Okay.
But first I want to pose this question to you.
Mm.
What makes a good entrance theme? It's open to both of you.
Something that gets you hyped up for the match, coming match.
If he wants to get jacked up.
I'm gonna get jacked up. My toes. Yeah, the gym muscles.
Protein shake.
Yeah.
You're eating at that new place in town, aren't you?
Yeah,
totally.
Pick your protein. Yeah. Pick your carbs.
Totally. You know me?
Sponsorship.
Yeah. Oh, yes, please. I don't know. Something that's a good song as well as, you know, a good entrance theme. Okay. Something you'd want to listen to. I don't know, yeah. It's tough.
In your everyday life.
Yeah, yeah.
Steve, what makes a good entrance theme?
Similar to what Finn said, I think it's something that it has to suit the character, the wrestler.
Yeah, the character.
The character. It has to suit the character. So, like a recent example I can think of is when the Usos turned heel. So the music had to change to suit that heel change.
Yes.
You couldn't have that thing they had before.
No.
Exactly.
So it just doesn't suit. So it's something that's got to suit the wrestler, the character, something that you'd want to listen to in everyday sort of music, or something that gets you hyped. Something that I think as well, crowd interaction is quite a big one.
Okay.
Fandango, for example, you wouldn't listen to it as a standalone. It's not going to go down as one of the greats, but people get involved and people get into it. And
it was number one on iTunes download.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's all of those things, and just something that's memorable, something that's got a hook, something that's catchy as well.
Something you're going to remember for a long, long time. I mean, I mean, there's entrance themes from the 80s that are still great now.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think both of you combined are absolutely spot on. Yeah. I think it has to suit the character, has to be a great song as well as, you know, a great entrance theme as well.
Yeah.
And I'm with the two of you. So, Steve, as you're our guest, run down your top 10.
Okay. Do you want me to give like an explanation after each?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. This changed up until about 5 minutes before the podcast.
Okay.
I'll do honourable mentions before I do my number one.
So. Okay.
So 10, I've gone with Edge, but specifically the one where it does the "You Think You Know Me" and then the
Alter Bridge one. The last one.
That's the one. I couldn't remember who it was.
On this day, absolutely clearly.
Anyway, there's going to be a lot of that going on now. Awesome song that you would listen to on its own.
Yep.
Suited the character, suited Edge perfectly. He had that look. That's the type of music he would definitely listen to.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen Alter Bridge play it live.
I don't know whether I have.
I saw him at Download, and I was walking by the main stage, and I was like, holy shit, that's Edge's theme song.
Nice.
I've probably seen Alter Bridge, but I probably didn't register that they were playing that. But so that's number 10.
Cool.
Nice.
Good song.
Very good.
Number 9, I've gone for a new one, probably the newest one on my list. So I've gone for Shinsuke Nakamura.
Yes.
I just think that opening bit is absolutely amazing.
Oh, God.
And it gives you goosebumps when the lights go down and it's got the, like, it's almost like a heartbeat thing, isn't it?
It's kind of
waving around. And that violin bit. I never thought I'd enjoy a violin part to a song so much. And it's just the whole... Amazing. And he makes it as well what it is.
Yeah.
For sure.
So the hand movements and the when he goes into the ring and he does that thing on the ropes, it's just absolutely awesome. It's
incredible.
It's a hoofing song.
It is completely hoofing.
It is.
And it's banging to listen to in your headphones.
Yeah,
well.
It is. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, quality. So the next one I've gone for... Bray Wyatt, his current one.
Yeah,
I don't know. Did he have? I'm guessing he didn't have that in NXT?
I don't know, because NXT wasn't on the network at that point. I didn't watch it on Sky Sports. Bad wrestling fan.
I forget what it's called.
It's called Broken Out in Love by Mark Crozer and the Rails.
That's the one.
Nice.
It's got a different name now, the WWE own it.
Yeah, balls to that.
Yeah, balls to them.
Bray Wyatt, trademark.
Great song, again, suits Bray Wyatt. The crowd have bought into it with this Fireflies thing.
That's very cool.
It's, a good song on its own. And obviously for us, we played it in the band as well. We used to cover it, play it acoustic. It'd be our opening song.
Yeah.
Nice.
And we played quite a few gigs, didn't we? We only had the one person ever come up to us and go, "Is that Bray Wyatt?" And we're like, "Yeah, it is."
We're waiting for it. We can retire it now. We haven't ever played it again.
Yeah. Someone knows what it is, because for ages we thought, "Yeah, we'll get away with this. Like, people think it's ours."
Yeah.
And someone went, "Yeah, it's Bray Wyatt's song, isn't it?" We're just going to stop playing now.
Yeah,
great song.
Yeah, it's outstanding.
So it's brilliant. And it was good when they did it live, was it 2 years ago in WrestleMania? That was pretty cool as well. So number seven, I've gone for Seth Rollins, just because it's a belting song.
Oh, it's awesome, yeah.
It's brilliant. It's my ringtone on my phone.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? Yeah. Or your alarm.
It's either that. It's one of the two, because I've got Kevin Owens as well.
Just loves the Graps.
I love the Graps, yeah. They just make good ringtones.
Nakamura.
Nice.
It's...
I'd get on that.
Yeah, I think I might need to do that as well. Yeah, great song. And it works for Rollins in both his heel and babyface form. Again, it suits him in terms of, you look at Rollins and you think that's the sort of music he would listen to.
Oh, for certain.
And, you know, whatever he does at the top of the ramp, it works as well with that. You know, so, great song. Would happily listen to it outside of watching wrestling. If it appeared shuffle on my MP3 player or whatever, or I would, I wouldn't skip it. So, it's a good song. Awesome. Gets you hyped as well a bit.
It does. It jacks you up.
I think for me as well, like when that music hit at WrestleMania and he ran down and he cashed in.
Oh, so good.
And we all marked out.
We
absolutely marked out at quarter past four in the morning. I think I jumped up and did a bit of shadow boxing. I was that jacked. I was like, yes, this is amazing. So that's quality. Number six. I don't know. I've got something now. I don't know whether to change it or not.
How's that?
No, I'm going to go for it. So I'm going to go with, and it's not a song that I would probably necessarily listen to on its own, but I just think it's a great entrance.
Okay.
So I'm going to go with Kurt Angle.
Okay.
Medal. Nice.
That was actually on my list for a little while. I debated, but that's a bit.
So I just think it's brilliant for him.
Yeah.
That whole, I've got a gold medal, I was at the Olympics, I'm this clean-cut American, and that sort of, the fanfare and everything. I just think it works so well. And now, obviously, you get the crowd interaction of the "you suck."
You suck.
And he plays up to that. And I can't wait to hear it at WrestleMania, whether it's just in the Hall of Fame bit.
I can't wait to hear it when the Patriot comes down, because it used to be the Patriots' entrance music.
All right.
Yeah. There used to be a wrestler in the late, probably 97.
Oh, yeah.
Used to be a masked wrestler with the Patriot in WWE. And he had that same entrance music.
Oh, right. Huh. Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. But yeah, I just think it's...
No one does. That's why they get away with it.
Yeah.
Everyone just forgets. And everyone just loves Kurt Angle.
So. Yeah. No, I just think for Angle, it's a great song. And it's... I got into wrestling late. Your fault. And that's just one of the first sort of wrestlers that I kind of, I'm like, oh, that's Kurt Angle.
Well, it was around that time when you started watching it, wasn't it?
Yeah. And like, it was like, he's got this cool entrance music, you recognise it instantly as soon as it hits. It's one of those that you could play half a second of it and you'd go, Kurt Angle. You'd know exactly who it is. So, bit of a random one, but I thought I'd put it in there. And there are some that I haven't picked that as actual songs, they're obviously far better than that.
Sure.
You know, because that's just...
Well, I mean, there's ones on mine that are yeah. obviously much better songs on it, but just yeah. from the fact that they're yeah. interest themes, it's awesome.
So, number five, I've gone for The Rock.
Which if one?
It's the Mel. Did you do?
Probably the most recent one.
Really?
Yeah.
One with the bigger drums when it kicks in after the If You Smell?
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom.
Yeah. yeah. And there's a bit more guitar in there as yeah. well. Just because, again, it's that instant, it's that recognisable.
That's The Rock. He's awesome.
And it's, yeah, it's The Rock. And as soon as the crowd pop, wherever, when that music hits, is insane.
Yeah.
And
there's only one other end, there's only one other music for me that, gets that sort of reaction, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be on yours, but
I'm guessing it's the one that's next on my list. But yeah, it's The Rock, it's amazing. And I was umming and ahhing whether this was going to be in my top 10 just because there are so many different versions of that. There's a slowed down version, there's one where he's talking more in it.
My favorite,
so I didn't know whether to put it in or take it out, but as a whole, it's yeah, it's good.
My favorite's the one from around 98 when he was in The Nation.
Yeah, it's and a bit slower, isn't it?
Yeah, he actually says, "Do you smell what The Rock is cooking?"
Yeah,
at the
yeah.
beginning of it, and then it kicks in. And The Nation had the same music at the same time, so it's not the "We Are the Nation of Domination" music. It was right. different music. It was like had some like funky sort of guitar. It was really
yeah.
cool.
Yeah. So yeah, The Rock at five, number four, Stone Cold.
Yep.
No, is that what you're thinking?
When that glass mm-hmm. breaks, there is no reaction like it.
No.
Yeah.
Absolutely nothing at all. And for me, that song, The Rock, and another one that's on my, potentially two, that are on my list.
Nobody in the world that doesn't know Stone Cold Steve Austin is, and that glass broken either.
No. Yeah, seriously.
You see, like anything, it's like when Donald Trump became president, there was videos everywhere from people who don't even watch wrestling
yeah.
of
yeah.
Stone Cold stunning Donald Trump.
Yeah, it's like the only man that can save us now is Stone Cold, and everyone's like, oh, I remember Stone Cold, yeah.
And you always see this video on Facebook that people always share, they're like, this is the greatest ending in SmackDown history. And it's like Undertaker coming down, then The Rock coming yeah. down. Then like,
is it the invasion? Is it the invasion angle?
It's around that time,
and he
yeah.
comes back, doesn't he? And he just clears house.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah.
He just, and that's the thing as well, with Stone Cold's entrance music, that music hits and the crowd go ballistic, and even if you knew whether it was coming or not, you were like, right, shit's about to get real.
Yeah, for sure.
Because he would then just stomp down that ring, go straight into that ring and be like, right, yeah. there was nothing at the top, you know, like Cena does and all that. Yeah. You know, it was just bang, walk. Music, you know, and he's gone. And it was, yeah, it's just awesome.
Yeah.
Absolutely awesome. Amazing. And there's been a few variations of that, but of Stone Cold's song as well, but I just think the classic, you know, if he was at WrestleMania this year coming out as a, you know, to speak or whatever.
Yeah.
It'd be that, you know, the whatever version they use for that would probably be the one that I would pick.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So top three, I've gone for Triple H, The Game.
Triple H.
Okay. The Motorhead one.
Yeah. The Motorhead okay. one.
Nice.
I think so. One, it's a good song anyway.
It is. I've heard it played on the radio.
Yeah,
I've on Total Rock. I think I played it.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, I've heard it. I've heard it on the radio as well. I think what makes this song more, I don't know, what's the word I'm looking for? You get more of a reaction now with that particular song because he's got the King of Kings one.
Which is crap, by the way.
Which is crap, which isn't on my list, either list.
Shouldn't be on anyone's list.
No.
Chris Jericho's list.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that's the only list he deserves to make.
Yeah.
He uses that, so Triple H uses The Game one now when he's wrestling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
that's the one that gets the reaction.
And that's the one that gets the reaction, and that's what I think has made it perhaps go up a notch a little bit, in terms of like, oh, it's the game one. He's gonna come out. He's gonna hit someone with yeah. a sledgehammer or you know, so that's again, it's that thing of, you know, shit's about to go down.
So the number one played WWE song on Spotify as well.
Is it really?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
Doesn't
you know, you have like the most played.
Yeah.
Like that's the top one.
Yeah. It's brilliant, and I saw Triple H live about 10 years ago, maybe longer. I don't know. Yeah, about 10 years ago. And the reaction was unbelievable.
Yeah.
It was... So Randy Orton was there that night as well. And got nowhere near the same reaction.
No. You know, Triple H. Everyone slates Triple H, but everyone loves Triple H.
But you know what? When I was younger, when I first started watching wrestling, I hated him.
Mm.
But now I realise, as I've got older and, you know, whatever, you realise that actually me hating him means that he was so convincing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he did his job, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's just that whole thing of him, you know, spitting water and all of that. It's just brilliant. The only one that came close to that, and I was umming and ahhing, is the one that is, well, it's Triple H / China. It's the time is now, because that's amazing. Oh, yeah. As well. That didn't make my top 10, but it's in my honourable mentions. So
cool.
Yeah, Triple H the Game, number 3. So number 2, these next two, they swap round about 4 times, but I've gone with this. So number 2 is a song that I think just sums up the Attitude Era, and it's D-Generation X.
Yep.
Interesting.
I just think you hear that start bit, the video that goes with it, it's all like, you know, it's green and black, and you've got strippers, and you've got all yeah. sorts, you've got tanks, and
all
you've
that
got
good stuff.
All that great stuff. Tanks and strippers, yeah. That's what we want. Yeah. So you've got, and that song, just like, you hear that song.
Which,
you
by
just
the way, think, is definitely the podcast name this week.
Tanks and strippers. Yes, we've got it.
Nice.
That song, just for me, I mean, yeah, you could say Angle, Rock, Stone Cold, Triple H, but that D-Generation X song for me is the Attitude Era,
and it's because a great song.
Yeah, because it was the it is a great song, because it's the whole Monday Night Wars thing as well. You know, those invade, you know, with them invading WCW, and that's just automatically what you think of. It had the catchphrase as well, you know, the whole DX thing. Brilliant song. That's actually, I've also got that on my phone as one of my notifications or something like that, alarm or something. So yeah, it's a great song. So before I do my number one, ones that didn't make the list. So just some of these are, you have to take them into context of crowd reaction and all that sort of thing. So I've gone for Shane McMahon.
Cool.
Was considered. Some of these were nowhere near my top 10, but I just put them down. So Shane McMahon, Vince McMahon.
Yeah,
of course.
Which randomly I heard on TalkSport the other morning.
Sure. Oh.
Sure. Yeah. Daniel Bryan, just because of the pop that it gets. Oh, yeah. That was actually my number 10, but I changed it like 2 minutes before we recorded. I mean, would I listen to Flight of the Valkyries on its own?
Well, that's the thing. I feel probably, stupid listening to it. Yeah.
Probably not. But when you see it,
it's awesome.
And I mean, the reaction he got the other week in, was it this? No, last week, wasn't it? In Seattle was, you know, it was incredible.
Oh, yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah,
so I'll just fly through these. Bobby Roode, just because it's fucking awesome. Oh, yeah. It's glorious. Finn Balor, because it's hoofing. It sounds like Royal Blood, and I like Royal Blood.
Yeah.
Yep.
Samoa Joe's current one, amazing. NWO.
Oh, God, no, NWO's one. I didn't even think to dive into WCW, that's the thing.
No. Now, I've got Orton, Voices, as well. That was my number 6, but I took it out, changed it for Angle. Taz.
Oh, Taz has got a good one.
Yeah.
Kevin Owens, Goldberg, Batista, both Cena songs, both Sheamus ones, which you were surprised at when I said that earlier. I think his latest one's
brilliant. Yeah, his latest one's awesome.
It's really good. But I do like the other one.
Just Shame for the thing.
Yeah. I think it's good.
I don't. I just don't.
The Triple H China one, which I mentioned. I quite like Evolution as well. It was a good song.
Yeah.
Bret Hart, Warrior, Hogan, Jericho, Sami Zayn, Brock Lesnar. It's not bad as a standalone song.
That's changed over time as well.
Yeah. AJ Styles. Brilliant. Nope, really good. Paige as well, because I think for a Divas song, it's really
Divas,
good.
Divas!
Yeah.
Sorry, women's wrestler song.
Divas.
RVD as well. And this one technically isn't an entrance music, but I wanted to talk about it because you will relate to it, Sonny. So, WrestleMania 17.
Oh, is it going to be Limp Bizkit?
Yeah.
My Way.
I hear that song and I instantly think...
Yeah, I think
of it. And I just think of WrestleMania and I think of the ending to that WrestleMania. So at the end of WrestleMania, when they do the... they put together a quick highlights package. don't they? When it finishes, they quick car lights packages, and that ended with Austin shaking Vince McMahon's hand. And I just remember me, you, and whoever, we were probably around Goodwin's house, just looking at each other like, what has just happened? And it's that song. When you hear that song, I just instantly have stunners and handshakes and chair shots going around in my head. You know, it's crazy. So, although technically not an entrance song, I thought I'd put it in there just because it links to wrestling.
Yeah. Absolutely. I'll always associate it with WrestleMania 17.
Now. Yeah, me too. For sure.
Awesome pay-per-view as well.
Yeah. Incredible.
Absolutely amazing.
Except for the gimmicks battle royal that'd be right at the
beginning. That's good to do with that.
It's funny, like, it's got Repo Man in it, that rules.
Triple H, Undertaker. Wow. Anyway, so my number one.
Oh, yeah, shit, you haven't done number one.
No, so my number one, drum roll, is CM Punk, Cult of Personality.
Of course.
Just because, as a song, I think it's absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
Yes. I just think it's.
And it works so perfectly for him as well.
It works perfectly for him, but for me, even if it wasn't a wrestler's entrance music, I would still think it's a brilliant song.
Yeah.
And I will admit, I hadn't heard of it until I heard.
I hadn't either.
But it's a song that's.
In fact, I knew the song because it was on Rock Band, I think.
Yeah, I think it was on some.
Yes, it was.
GTA Vice City, I think, maybe.
Maybe.
It was on one of the GTAs, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think it was Vice City, I think it was maybe San Andreas. Yeah, I can't remember either way. It was on one of them.
Yeah,
it's just for me. As a standalone, it is a brilliant song. It's awesome, and for a song that isn't a WWE original in terms of it's a song that another band has done. I think it's the best one.
Yeah.
It suits him, and I just think as well when we first heard it. When the music hit, there was nothing on the Titantron.
Yeah.
That's
Cena
cool,
was in the... Had he just been beat up or something? He just won a match, hadn't he? And the music hit and he's looking. Everyone's like, what's this?
It's when he came back, isn't it?
Because, and it went on for ages.
Yeah.
And then he came out and the crowd just went ballistic.
Yeah, because Cena just won the new WWE title and CM Punk came out with the old one.
Yeah. It only been gone like a week.
Exactly, yeah. They should have stretched it out longer.
Yeah, they should have stretched it out longer. For sure. It's a great song.
Yeah, and it's one of those, it gets you jacked.
Well, again, I think of it as a wrestling fan. If I hear it, I automatically think CM Punk.
Yeah,
definitely. Yeah. And crossing over into another sport, so to speak, when he used it for his UFC entrance, that was the best part of his night.
Because
when that music hit and he started walking out, you were like, oh shit, this could be good, and then it wasn't, but it's just a superb song.
I mean, he was cocky about it as well, because he was laughing on his way down to me thinking, yeah, look at the wrestling. He just knew that was what was crossing his mind when he heard that entrance, when he heard his entrance music as that, and he was laughing and smiling and
and then he got beaten up.
So that's
good list.
That's my list. Yeah, yes.
it's a good list.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of the list kind of shows that obviously I didn't really get into wrestling until the late 90s. But you know, obviously, I know what Hogan's music is and Warrior and Bret Hart.
Of course,
even as a kid, when I didn't watch that much wrestling, I knew.
You knew Hulk Hogan
I knew who they were, yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone knows who Hulk Hogan is.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
absolutely.
It was a good list. Good, solid, comprehensive list.
Yes.
And good explanations too.
Yes, very good.
Finn, run me down your list.
Right. Okay, let's do this. So, mine has been compiled until like 2 seconds before we start recording this.
you've not had a week.
Yeah. Right.
I've had less time than you.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
I got told Monday.
Right, what did we get? Anyway, so number 10, my number 10 would be Kane's, specifically the one with the lyrics.
Okay.
Yeah, the one that's actually kind of a song.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I really like that one. That's always at my head for some reason when I think of Kane.
Yeah. That's his best one as well, I think.
Yeah, I think so. That's always a song that points to my head.
Yeah, it's a good one. I forgot it's called.
Now you're singing like that. I remember it.
Obviously, yeah. Just cool. Cool song. Cool song.
Great
cool
song, theme. Yeah.
Suits a wrestler. Excellent. Good stuff. Number 9, another song that keeps getting stuck in my head whenever I think of this wrestler, is Gangrel's.
Yeah, what a fucking awesome song.
That's an awesome song.
It's amazing. Bam, bam,
bam, bam, bam. If you ask any... So many wrestling fans will have that in there. Like we had, I had that on tweets earlier on. Like,
oh, yeah.
People were tweeting us, yeah.
Awesome.
They're like, Gangrel, Gangrel.
Yeah, so when I was listening, doing my research and that came on, I was like, oh, yes.
That one is awesome as well.
It is really good.
Fanging and banging. That's what he is. Oh, nice. His catchphrase now.
Awesome. Well, let's hope these two round, because I've been in the wrong order. But number eight is one out left field. I don't think it's Steve mentioned, but it's Drew McIntyre.
That's a really good one.
It's a really good theme, yeah.
That is.
I was looking through themes earlier today, and it's like, oh yeah, Drew McIntyre.
We talked about the Drew McIntyre theme. Oh no, was it you? Or it might be someone else, but we were talking about this, and that's an underrated one, because it just sort of goes under the radar, I think.
Yeah, it's a very cool song.
It is a very cool song.
I hope when he inevitably comes back to WWE, I think he will, he uses that song.
I think he should, for sure, because it was awesome.
Yeah. Awesome song. Go into it. number seven, going for a modern one, it's Bobby Roode. Glorious, of course. Glorious.
It suits him so well.
It's perfect. And the way he's stood at the entrance on the ramp with his cool, like, dressing gown. cool robe. Yeah.
Robe thing, come on.
Yeah. super cool. And crowd sings along and the whole glorious bomb thing with Gargano and Ciampa.
Yeah.
Very cool. Number six, I've gone for The Rock. Probably the same version as Steve.
Okay.
Just iconic. If you're some
agreed, yeah. I mean, I'm with you. I haven't gone for any of The Rock's entrance music on my list at all.
Interesting.
But that's not to say that I don't love The Rock's entrance music.
Yeah, it's super cool.
I would have picked a completely different one to you guys. I'd have gone for the 98 one. That's my own personal preference.
That's my least favourite one. But that's just a little slower.
It's a bit too slow for me.
But that was when The Rock was a real bad guy then.
Yes.
And he'd only just sort of started being The Rock as opposed to Rocky Maivia.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was just something about it that was so cool.
Cool. So number five, another iconic one, which Steve mentioned, Triple H, The Game. It's just an amazing song on its own and with the entrance and everything. I love it. It's perfect.
It is absolutely perfect. And Motorhead did an impeccable job.
Yeah, excellent. That's on the sang it live, and I think Lemmy forgot afterwards. Yeah. Thought about the game. Now you're playing. Thought about the game. Didn't
it's
play.
At the beginning, it's like, we are Motorhead. We're going to kick your ass. Like, fair enough. Like, I'll always remember it.
Yeah.
One time. Number four, maybe controversial, Chris Benoit. I know. Awesome song there.
Who is he?
I don't know. Some guy who's, might have been, I can't remember.
You mean Chris Benoit?
Crispin.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Crispin Bois.
Yeah, that's the one.
Now, the one with the words, right?
The one with the words, yes.
Okay.
And just again, it's a very cool song on its own.
A very cool song by Our Lady Peace is what the band were called.
That's the one, yes.
It's a really, really good song.
Very cool. And again, suited the character, Beverly.
Yeah, great.
Number three, I've gone for Stone Cold, which is that same reason to Steve. Also, honorable mention to the Disturbed version, which he used for a little while.
Yeah, oh, that was awesome.
Yeah, so cool. Good, yeah.
Yeah.
I remember when he came back at Unforgiven 99. I think it was Unforgiven 99 or 2000 when it was the whole who ran over. It must have been Unforgiven 2000.
2000,
because,
yeah.
He got run over by Rikishi or whatever. And Shane McMahon said he thought he knew who did it.
Yeah.
And obviously he blamed Steve Blackman because he was in a feud with Steve Blackman at the time. Yeah. And then Austin came out and did an amazing stunner on him. Great times.
Happy days.
Happy days. Number two, I'm going to put Edge. His more recent one.
The Ultimate Edge one. Okay.
That's the one. Just amazing. Edge is probably my favourite wrestler back in the day.
Okay.
I grew my hair long because of Edge, which is a mistake. No respects. But
do we have any photographic evidence?
No, it's not burnt at all. It's gone forever. That's it. I've probably find it before I look through it.
Yeah. Which Edge is...
Brilliant.
We were talking about, we were texting each other, weren't we, a few weeks ago about our top 10 wrestlers.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, I'd probably throw Edge in my top 10.
I would, for sure, yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Very, very cool. And number one, I've gone for another modern one, Nakamura. Shinsuke Nakamura. Yeah, it's perfection. It's like, I didn't know a whole lot about Nakamura before his first match at NXT. That song on his own and that entrance just sold them on me to like instantly. He's like, right, I get it.
Yeah.
I get the hype now.
Well, it's like the same thing. Well, Lottie hadn't heard of him before. I had, because I'd watched Wrestle Kingdom the previous couple of years. And she was like, okay, I'd never heard of this person, but automatically, like straight away, as soon as like she saw the entrance and heard the music, it's like, okay.
Yeah, Goosebumps, just amazing. Yeah. And then, yeah, honorable mentions, I got CM Punk's original theme.
Oh, the one by Killswitch Engage?
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's very, that's cool. And again,
yeah, it's awesome as well.
It's heavy.
Yeah.
God, it's seriously heavy, yeah.
When he first got Sinner's Money in the Bank, and then that was playing, that's just cool. Cool stuff.
It was awesome when, during, you know that Cena match, the one where he wins it and then goes?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
At Money in the Bank?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
That when that music hits and the crowd go ballistic, that is unbelievable. It's obviously in Chicago, so it's amazing, but...
Yeah. Cool moment.
God, it was awesome.
So cool. And also put Joe Goes Down on there, just because he's been using the same theme now since his entire career, and it's one of the few people who have, and it's just cool for that, I think.
Yeah, I'm with you.
And it's a cool song.
Yeah, it's a good song.
Yeah. And yeah, that's my briefly ran down list. Some similar to Steve's, but a couple extra ones in there.
Okay.
Yeah, it's cool.
Straight in at number 10 on the Sunny Hit Parade of wrestling entrance themes is The Million Dollar Man.
Oh, nice.
Because it's just so iconic. Right? As soon as that money hits, you know it's the Million Dollar Man.
Yeah.
And he's got his cackle in there. He's got his everybody's got to pay.
Yeah,
it's just awesome. And I've always loved the entrance theme, and it's always stuck with me. And
awesome.
I love it still. Number 9, I have put Cult of Personality in there.
Cool.
I had it at number 9 because I didn't know if I could have it, because it was, I know it's a wrestling theme, but it's a song as well.
Yeah, yeah.
But I had to have it in there because every time I hear it, I now think of wrestling and CM Punk. So
yeah.
For me, it just has to be in there. Number 8, pretty much for the same reasons as you, I have Bray Wyatt,
nice.
The Broken Heart in Love in there because we played it and because it's just so good. And I remember when like he first debuted with that music, and instantly everyone was like, "What's that song? What is that song?"
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it made Mark Crozier and the Rails just infinite money overnight. Yeah. Just big stars overnight for that one song.
I remember, it wasn't long after I heard it that I started looking and thought, I need to own this song in some format.
Because not only was it a good wrestling, a good song for the character, it was just a great song as well. And if you listen to the words, it is a weird song, but it's really, really good as well. Number 7, I've gone for Basic Thugonomics.
Word life.
Yeah. When Cena first debuted that character and that song was playing, I was like, this is fucking awesome. This is like the coolest thing ever. Like, this guy who is a complete douchebag, pants-wearing, spiky-haired, crap wrestler is now rapping and doing funny things on TV, and it rules. And the song is brilliant. Right, and he's
cool.
You know what, he's not a bad rapper himself, and he doesn't disgrace himself in his music, so fair play to him. But that one over My Time Is Now, absolutely, all day. Cool. And when he came down with it, when he was feuding with The Rock, and they had the he came down with Basic Thugonomics, I was like, yes,
yeah, that's cool.
I'm so happy.
Yeah, I think that's my preferred Cena song as well.
Yeah,
yeah, I prefer that one. I mean, I like the other one because again, it's just. It's now iconic, isn't it?
I think it's way past the point of him being able to change it as well.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, you perhaps wouldn't want him to change it, but the Thugonomics one is.
The only way they'd ever change it would be turn heel, because he'd have to.
Yeah.
Maybe just get Thugonomics back.
Yeah, oh, maybe.
That'd be brilliant.
Yeah.
Number 5, I've gone for Gold Dust.
Ooh, wow. Interesting.
There aren't many, in my opinion, better instrumental entrance themes than Gold Dust, especially from that era. Like, you listen to it, and it's just like, this is so perfect, like, for him as a character. But you listen to it as an actual song, and it's like, this is absolutely superb.
Mm.
It's just, not many people would probably go for it, but it's one that's always sort of stuck with me as an entrance theme. Like, that's why I always watch Goldust Entrance when, like, I play him on the wrestling games and stuff like that. Just because his music's so good. I've heard it before, like, when he first came in, and they had the whole Shattered Dreams entertainment thing, and when he wasn't fucking around with R-Truth and all that.
Oh, God.
Like when he was real Gold Dust, when he, you know, when he was doing something that was meaningful.
Yeah, we had a wig and all that.
That heel character with that music.
Yeah, it's so cool. Yeah,
really good.
Number 5, I've gone for Gangrel.
Nice.
Same reasons as you.
Yeah.
It just rules. Bow, bow, it's like, bow, It's just everything. You listen to it in headphones now. Like, we didn't have the luxury of impeccable headphones back in the day.
Yeah.
But if you, I was listening to it probably this morning, and it's just like, it's just so good.
Yeah, it's super cool.
I know I'm going down that sort of route of saying everything is so good, but they just are. They just,
yeah. That's why I'm on the list.
Not you know, the most high profile of wrestlers, but, you know, have one of the most iconic entrance themes probably ever. And if you ask most wrestling fans, they would absolutely say they loved it.
Yeah. It's one of those as well that if, say he came back at the Royal Rumble or something, that would hit and people would go mad.
Yeah,
and they would,
and you'd straight away, you know, if you're watching it with your mates, you'd go, oh, shit. Like, you know, it's one of those.
To be honest, we could probably go to Bedford Civic Hall and watch Gangrel wrestle and he would have that entrance music.
Awesome, let's do it.
Yep. Probably get to meet him after as well, it'd be amazing. number four, it was easy to pick because this guy's got so many different versions of his entrance theme, but I had to pick the Ministry of Darkness version of the Undertaker's entrance theme because it's just a version of the Undertaker's entrance theme that isn't slow and it isn't boring and it suited heel Undertaker perfectly because he was doing the Ministry of Darkness thing with Viscera and Midian and the Acolytes and all that sort of stuff, but it had electric guitar, it had like the real heavy sort of drums, and it was like just awesome. And it had like the amazing breakdown bit in the middle as well. Yeah. And it had him like mumbling some nonsense at the beginning and like a bit in the middle, and it's easily the Undertaker's best entrance theme.
When I was listening to some entrance music the last couple of days, that one came on and I listened to it in full. I forgot how good it was.
Yeah, it's really good. But it is one of them ones you forget because Undertaker has had so many. He had
some bad ones as well.
He's had some very bad ones. Yeah. I mean, he obviously had the normal, the Death March one that he has right now, and even more of a stripped back version of that when he first came in.
Yeah.
He had Rollin' by Limp Bizkit. He had that other American Badass one.
Oh, God.
You've done it now.
Yeah,
that one. Which, in hindsight, isn't...
Meant American Badass.
Oh, yeah, American Badass as well. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Great song, anyway.
Yeah, well, yeah.
But this one is the Undertaker's best traditional entrance theme.
Well, he's got a whole album. They released an album just of Undertaker music.
Nice.
Yeah. He's even got the Corporate Ministry on, which is also awesome because it's got, like, No Chance in Hell and Undertaker sort of mixed in.
Yeah.
Huh.
Very cool. Number three, I've gone for Nakamura.
Yeah.
I don't need to talk about it anymore. It's awesome. Number two, I've gone for Real American. I couldn't not have it in there.
You had to have Hogan on there.
Yeah. I had to have Hogan in there.
Because Hogan hates you.
Yeah, Hogan thinks
he does hate me, but that's fine. I'm fine with it. I'm at peace with it. But when that music hits, it's like, I don't know, it's just something about it. It just takes me back to being a kid.
Yeah.
Like when I first started watching wrestling in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, Hogan was wrestling.
Yeah.
And like that music was just, again, when that first dun, 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 yeah. It's like the crowd went crazy for it.
Yeah.
And like I'll always have very fond memories of it. And that is the reason it's so high in my list.
Cool.
You'll get some crowd reaction at WrestleMania when that music hits.
God. Yeah, when he just. And he will be at WrestleMania.
I think so.
Yes.
If not before.
They started talking about it. He's started appearing on things, hasn't he?
Yeah. And like the cosplayers are in the crowd again, not being booted out. But yeah, Hogan had to be in there. This wasn't... Number one wasn't a difficult choice for me. And it has to be the Triple H / China.
I thought you were going to pick that.
it had to be just because, I don't know. I think it's better than the Motorhead one just because of when he first started being the game, like when it that bit at the beginning, it like said start game on the Titantron, then the lights went down and the green lights came up for like Triple H on the entrance ramp, and like that bit like that, it's like because he had a version of it without words before, but then when he had the version with words, and it's like the guitar in and the, you know, it's sort of what the game, the Motorhead one is now. If you listen to it, it's just a great entrance theme, and it's like you can do it, the way like when he used to spit the water out on the ramp and stuff like that, and but same as he pretty much does now. But I just feel like it worked so perfectly with that, and it suited the time as well. The time when he had that music, and it's just, I listened to it for the first time in ages, just a couple of days back, and I was walking up the hill, and I was like, God, this absolutely jacks me up. Like, it just does. Like, when it kicks in, and it, I don't know, it's superb. And that's why it's my favorite, my personal favorite entrance theme of all time.
Cool.
So, yeah. I don't really have any honorable mentions. I mean, you've pretty much talked about all the ones that I love. I mean, I love, like, ones from the 80s, like, the 90s, sorry, like Razor Ramon. I love the Ultimate Warrior one, and like stuff like Brutus Beefcake and Boss Man, and the, you know, ones Boss like Man, that yeah. that I'll yeah, always sort of have real fun memories of. And even listen to stuff like the Jim Johnston stuff from the Attitude Era, like even like stuff like Val Venus and
Hello,
you know, just stuff like that. Where they were just really great, well put together entrance themes.
Yeah.
I think the
Godfather.
And I think even the one, like the ones that are around now, because I don't think Jim Johnston does them anymore. It's someone else, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
It's like a group of producers that do them.
Yeah.
I'll be able to tell you because it's on Spotify.
Yeah,
but
I was going to say it's.
There's stuff like the Roderick Strong entrance theme and TJ Perkins and even like Mustafa Ali and. Stuff like that. I mean, I think maybe Jim Johnston does still do a few actually, because I've noticed he's got a credit on Stephanie's actually.
Oh, Aquarium.
Yeah. Oh, CFO dollar sign.
Ah,
yeah.
That's the one.
Yeah. I'm just looking at Alexa Bliss's old entrance theme now, which is also very good. But there's, you know, entrance themes have actually gotten better now. Like they've
picked up. The NXT ones are really good.
Yeah, the NXT ones are amazing. Yeah. Really, really good. But yeah, good. In-depth discussion about entrance themes there. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, that's that.
It was very good.
Yeah.
I'm glad we've done that. Nice topic of the show this week.
I had fun researching it as well.
Yeah, I did. I love going by any excuse to listen to entrance themes.
Came across some absolute whoppers, though.
Yeah, there's some terrible ones, yeah.
Oh, man.
Oh, God, yeah.
Still scarred by League
of Nations. We'll save that for another...
still scarred by League of Nations.
Oh, God. Honestly. Yeah, League of Nations wasn't good.
No,
it was terrible.
Bad faction, bad music. Bad everything. Yeah. Bad time for wrestling.
Just
bad time, yeah. Yeah, we'll have a top 10 worst entrance themes episode in a few weeks, maybe.
Yeah, good idea.
Right, let's move on to talking about actual wrestling.
Okay.
Actual graps.
Oh, wait, no, before we do that.
What's that?
I'm going to, I did tweet out asking people what their favourite entrance themes were. I'm going to run through them very, very quickly.
Cool.
So, not quite a few, actually. Martin Dixon, Billy Kidman's in WCW. That was a very good one. And he used it when he first came into WWE also.
Awesome.
Motor Greg, as in like Motorhead. He's put Ken Shamrock, both of Steve Blackman's and Cactus Jack's WWF one.
Cool.
Steve Blackman's entrance theme was awesome.
Yeah, it was.
DC Matthews of the New Age Insiders tweeted and put Gangrel is up there among the all-time greats.
Of course.
Excellent. Brian Tripp Bradshaw.
Yeah.
D'Lo Brown, Gangrel, Edge's D-Lo rated R theme.
Look at the real deal now. Wow.
A lot of love for Edge's one, actually. Cruiserweight King. Nothing gets me hyper than Edge's theme.
Yeah, Edge is excellent.
Donnie Devious, Demolition, Slick, Jake Roberts, Rick Martel, Sid Justice, and the Mounties first theme.
Oh, excellent.
Old school.
Yeah.
Old school. What else we got here? Dan Lafar says the Vampiro one for WCW.
Ooh.
And also, Benoit, not the one that you picked, the other one.
Oh, it's him. Okay.
This is Gibbs, Gilbs rather, which is Craig, who runs Courage, which is very, very cool. Triple H, my time, same as me.
Nice.
Rich, tweeted and said with the two cool entrance theme.
Oh, yeah. I like that one, actually. It's nice, peaceful.
Yeah.
Little,
So thank you to anybody who tweeted us their favourite entrance themes. Appreciate it.
Yes. Good stuff. Thank you. Awesome.
Right. Elimination Chamber was this past Sunday.
Sure was.
And it was pretty good.
Pretty okay.
It was pretty WWE pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Let's skim through it.
Okay. So the first match we had...
Because I feel like there's going to be much to discuss coming out of it.
Yeah. The first match... Well, technically the first match we had was Mojo versus...
Kurt Hawkins,
which we're not going to talk about.
Come on.
Yeah, of course. Because it was garbage.
Yeah.
The first real match we had... was Becky Lynch versus Mickie James, which was pretty good, I thought.
Yeah, it was fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pretty good start. Mickie hit the mid kick, Becky went under the ropes, then Becky countered Mickie's like DDT thing into like rolled up and won the match.
The DDT, by the way, that we questioned on the stream.
Yeah, we questioned. I said, I was like, no, yeah, it is a thing. And you were like, no, it's a thing. So yeah, this thing.
It is, apparently, it is. Yeah.
So for predictions, we both had Mickie James to win that. So both wrong. No points yet. Then we had probably the most baffling match of the night. Dolph Ziggler versus Kalisto and Apollo Crews. What was this match? Why?
Well,
I don't get it.
When we talked about it last week, it was sort of like, this match has to have some sort of purpose. Like, I said, maybe Apollo could turn heel. That would make perfect sense from a storyline perspective, and it would also refresh Apollo's character.
Much needed, yes.
But no.
Nope.
It was very strange.
No.
So Dolph came down while Kalisto was making his entrance. Sacked him, threw him against the wall, and he was out for the most of the match.
Broke the board.
Yeah,
broke the LED board, yeah.
Yeah. So it's basically just one-on-one match for most of it. Apollo and Dolph. Then Kalisto came back towards the end of the match. Apollo hit him with a powerbomb and then won the match with that. And it's kind of like, so the two face guys beat the one heel guy. Because it's 2-on-1, so of course they would.
I mean, he got his revenge after.
Yeah, then he attacked out with the chair and like attacked Apollo's foot. And it was kind of weird, and what's the point?
One thing I can do without here is the crowd chanting that this thank you thing that they're into at the minute.
Thank you, Dolph.
If they don't like something, then someone comes down, they're like, oh, thank you. Thank you, Ziggler. They were chanting that. And I just thought, you've no idea how disrespectful it is. I know you pay your money to go in and watch wrestling and do whatever you want, but that's garbage behaviour.
They did it the other week when Neville came back, didn't they?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, thank you, Neville. You're saving the Cruiserweight division. It's like, it doesn't need saving.
It's fine.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. We're saving you from watching two very talented wrestlers, though. Is that what this is?
Yeah.
What I see here now is Apollo being out for a while. And this is, this is how I see it going from here. I see him coming back, and I do see him turning heel. I really do, but I see him turning on Kalisto.
Interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I thought the same as you guys that Apollo would turn heel.
It seemed like I was setting up something, but...
Yeah, I mean, I kind of stupidly... something I need to stop doing before pay-per-views is looking at the betting odds.
Oh, yeah.
Because it just gives it away.
Yeah.
So I knew Ziggler was going to win. Even up until midnight, because I was still awake, I thought, I'll have a quick look just before the pay-per-view starts. No change. So I thought, right, Ziggler's going to win. But Cruz could still turn heel.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
You guys had it as I can't remember how did you have it, actually?
We basically had it as Cruz turning on Kalisto and then basically beating him down.
Yeah, and then Dolph winning the match.
Yeah, and Dolph winning, yeah.
I do see now Cruz turning heel on Kalisto when he comes back.
Yeah, could happen.
Sorry, no. The odds weren't that Ziggler was going to win. The odds were that that Cruz and Kalisto were going to win. Okay, so they're going to win, but this heel turn could still happen, couldn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
they'll win the match, have their arms in the air, then whack. Yeah. That's what I had fully expected, and then it just kind of finished. I was like, okay, no heel turn.
Yeah, very strange.
Yeah, very very strange indeed. Seems ultimately very pointless, but yeah. I really hope for a change in fortunes for Cruz down the line, because it's not his fault that he's been booked so badly. I just think he was brought to the main roster too early.
Too early.
Yeah, for sure. He was better.
Should have had the NXT Championship first, I think.
Yeah, at least it too. Okay. Then we had the tag team turmoil match, which was a bit shite, really. it started off with Rhino and Heath beating Breezango, which is... And then they beat the Four Villains.
We had that. We predicted, didn't we?
Yeah, I think so.
They'd be the first ones.
And then the Four Villains came down and they got beaten by Heath and Rhino. Usos beat Heath and Rhino. And then the American Alpha beat the Usos. And then the Usos attack American Alpha after being eliminated, leaving them pretty much hopeless against the Ascension. So you think, oh, Ascension's going to win the tag title. It's cool. But then somehow, despite the fact that American Alpha were like beaten and helpless, Ascension still don't win. I think that only serves to make the Ascension look bad rather than having American Alpha look good.
But the booking has been so strong in the Ascension's favour recently. Yeah. It's weird because...
Yes.
I mean, don't get me wrong, I didn't want to see them win the titles yet.
Yeah, maybe not.
I do see them having the titles maybe at some point this year.
Yeah, hopefully.
It's their time. It has to be. Otherwise, don't have them there. It's a fucking waste of time.
Yeah. But yeah, that's made it look really kind of crap because... Yeah.
Yeah, what a full strength Ascension versus a beaten and broken American Alpha, and they still don't win.
Exactly, so. It's dumb. But we both had American Alpha to win that, so we both get a point at least. Ding. That's something. Ding, ding. Then we had surprisingly decent Natalia versus Nikki, which was crap ending, but the sort of match itself was pretty okay.
Yeah, sure.
Nikki slows, but barely hanging on, so that's a highlight.
Awesome.
ended with a double count out because, I don't know, reasons.
Just look me some Nikki.
Yeah. Also, the weird thing I noticed, they called the SDF a fearless lock. It's an SDF, guys. It's only because of Cena. Cena's called it the SDF.
The fearless lock is so unimaginative.
I know,
well.
It's like the Emma lock or the Asuka lock.
Yeah, it's just so crap. It's like, come on.
It's an SDF, for God's sake. Ugh.
Damn. Yeah.
But yeah, neither of us get a point because it's none against.
It was also when it was called the STFU when Cena used it, but then you can't use FU anymore because it's not PG.
Oh, well, yeah.
Bull.
Yeah. So yeah, that was the thing. I think we had probably the match, probably the second best match of the night, Randy Orton versus Luke Harper, which was excellent. I thought Luke Harper came across very well, despite losing. Do you think he should have won, maybe?
Yeah.
Because Randy Orton's going to WrestleMania anyway, despite whether he wins or loses. But it was a very good match, showed off everything he can do. And cool.
Yeah, I thought it was good. I'm a fan of Luke Harper anyway.
Yeah, me too.
I don't think Randy Orton. I understand why Randy Orton did win, but I don't think it would have hurt him to not win.
Exactly. Yeah, would have helped. Would have helped Luke Harper more than it would have hurt Randy Orton.
Yes, you're right.
Yeah.
Oh God, go with that.
Yeah. So that's like a between match thing. Natalya once again attacking
Nikki.
Predictions. Oh right, yeah. Predictions. So. You had nobody would win for some reason. I had Harper would win, so neither of us get a point.
Well, it could have ended double count out like Nikki versus Natalya did.
It could have. But didn't.
Yeah.
So neither of us get a point. It's still 1-0. Then, between matches, we had Natalya once again attacking Nikki backstage. So this is going to drag on.
Yeah, it needs to finish now because it's been going on for ages and ages. And it's like, okay, we get it now. We've had your backstage brawls. You've had your match. It's time now to not. Oh wait, this is leading into the
Maurice
submitting Maurice with the covering Maurice in makeup.
Yeah,
Jesus.
Because there's a rumor going around that a match at WrestleMania is going to be Cena and Nikki versus The Miz and Maurice, which would be terrible.
I don't think it'd be terrible as a match.
I'd rather see Cena versus The Miz.
It's terrible as a concept. I mean, Maurice isn't a bad wrestler. I mean, she was the Divas champ. Divas. She was the Divas champion, and you know, she was a fine wrestler.
Yeah, it's just there's better things for both, all involved for.
But it's better to have that one match than maybe two separate matches.
Maybe. I don't know. It's weird.
Well, see, is it?
Hmm.
I'm quite interested in seeing Maurice wrestle again. I have to be honest, I am. But
I guess it.
I do think there's better things that, you know, maybe Miz and Cena could do, but looking at how things are going, they're both going to end up in the mid-card anyway, because it looks like the main event scene has sort of already worked itself out, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that pretty much confirms that this match is going to happen at WrestleMania.
It's just like, we go back to the Enzo's penis thing.
Yeah, it's all because.
It's the same sort of nonsense, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's not as bad, but it's, it's similar.
You covered my wife in makeup!
How dare you?
No, it's bad. When you think of it.
Yeah, true.
Don't cover my wife in makeup, you hussy!
But I remember years ago, wasn't there a Jericho-Kane feud many years ago where it all started because Jericho accidentally bumped into Kane, spilled coffee on him?
Probably, yeah.
And then it was like, no, we're going to feud for two pay-per-views. I spilled coffee on me, dickhead.
That's how it worked then. It was two pay-per-views and you were done.
Yeah.
Then you're on to your next feud.
Yeah. It's going to be a thing, isn't it?
Yeah,
it certainly is. So we might as well just enjoy it.
Yeah. Yep.
The worst part about this Nikki and Natalya feud is that they've done all this scrapping on the floor and no boobs have fallen.
Yeah, that's a shame.
No boobs, no glory.
No nip slip, nothing.
Yeah.
Shame on you, WWE.
Yeah. Surely Vince McMahon was sort of a big advocate for that sort of thing as well.
You'd think so, wouldn't you?
You look like you're about to do the voice.
I was going to, but I'm going to have to. I'll leave it.
Okay. So then we had Alexa Bliss versus Naomi for the SmackDown Women's title.
Mm-hmm.
Good match. Naomi ended up winning, which is a surprise.
Very.
Not sure why. I mean, I know WrestleMania is in her hometown, but maybe then would have made more sense for her to win it at WrestleMania. drug.
Maybe. I'm not a big fan of... I mean, I like Naomi.
Yeah.
But I don't like her winning the championship now. Mm. I think Alexa was on too much of a good run.
Yeah.
And had too much momentum behind her to actually drop the belt just yet.
Yeah, I agree.
If you have to lose it at WrestleMania, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. That would make more sense, I thought.
There's very puzzling things happening with the title in WWE at the minute. I'm sure have some sort of direction that they're going in, but I mean, it's the same on Raw this week. Well, with the with the championship changing hands, it's a puzzling decision. And I mean, I'll talk about the Raw when we get to it because I think I know why they've done it now. But it's a very interesting decision, and I want to see Alexa win it back because she was doing good things with the belt and looking very strong. Don't get me wrong, Naomi will have one hell of an entrance at WrestleMania.
Yeah, probably.
Oh, God, yeah.
But that's not the reason to win the title. Maybe they just thought, well, she's going to have it at some point.
Yeah, you have to know, get over it.
Like I say, it just seems to have come from nowhere, doesn't it, as well?
Yeah, literally nowhere. She like came out randomly on SmackDown, didn't she?
Yeah, she'd been away as well. She hadn't been on TV for a few... It felt like a few weeks anyway. And then it was, I'm going to challenge for the title. Then Alexa came down, didn't she? Said, no, not happening. Then it happened, and now she's champ. So.
Yes. Move on.
Yeah, very.
That brings us to the main event, which is, of course, the Elimination Chamber match itself, which was great. I thought it was probably the best Elimination Chamber match ever, probably.
I thought it was definitely the best one in recent memory.
Yeah, yeah.
For me, at least.
Yeah.
It's gotten a bit stale, and it needed a year off.
For sure.
100%.
A couple of years, they had like three in one night.
I know.
And, like a tag team.
They had like an IC title one, and it's like,
that IC title one was terrible.
So bad. Mark Henry's chamber broke.
Mark Henry's chamber broke, didn't know what to do, so they had to. Oh, God, it was.
So bad.
if you're going to have it, have one.
Yeah, exactly.
And I thought it was good. I like the redesigned cell. I think it is much prettier and a lot more wrestler friendly, I want to say, than the previous one.
Yeah.
And it allows for better spots, I think.
Yeah, I would say. The floor outside of the ring wasn't as like...
No, it was padded.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
But at the same time, you don't need to kill yourself wrestling.
Exactly.
And have yourself smashed on... People in the crowd obviously couldn't tell because they were still sort of, going nuts for it. Obviously on TV, the illusion is not there.
Yeah.
But you don't need steel everywhere.
No, I agree.
I mean, you can still have the glass and you can still go through that. That's safe. The top of the pods, well, they're now square as opposed to being rounded as they were before.
Mm-hmm.
And they're flatter on top. So whereas before it was chain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was like, okay, if you're going to be doing stuff off the top, there's a lot of room for error there.
Yeah,
but now it's flat and it's solid, and you can sort of walk around freely on the top of it, and it's fine.
Yeah,
but I'm impressed. I'm impressed with the new design of the cell.
Me too.
Yeah, I quite like the bit where I think it was Ambrose was smacking AJ's head.
Yeah.
Against the person.
Oh, yeah,
so the camera had come.
Yeah.
The camera came round, didn't
it? Yeah.
And. Did that a couple of times. It looked really cool. The camera angle was brilliant. It was
super cool.
You had creative guys in there.
Yes.
Whereas before, don't get me wrong, if you had The Rock and Cena and some of the people in there, it's like, okay, but they aren't going to push the envelope as far as, The Rock's not going to take a superplex from the top of a pod, is he?
Yeah.
No.
And, but when you've got AJ and Dean Ambrose and people like that who, have worked Dean Ambrose was in CZW. And AJ is obviously very innovative. I'm trying to think of who else was in there off the top of my head. Tired mind. But there was guys in there that you knew were capable of pulling off good spots, but are also very safe as well.
Yeah.
So, just for that reason alone, for the fact that the spots were well thought out and it wasn't ridiculously over the top, and it just worked so well from a pacing point of view as well. It was just a perfect chamber match, and
it was.
They need to take note going forward, not to overdo it, and just to have the one in one night.
For sure, it's very cool.
Agreed.
The crowd are dead otherwise. It's like when you have three in one night, you're like, well, I've already seen this now.
Yeah,
there's nothing to be excited for.
No. So Ambrose eliminated Corbin to begin with. He's distracted by the Miz, and so Ambrose rolled him up. Three counts, and then Corbin went nuts and beat the crap out of Ambrose. Left him in the middle of the ring for the Miz to pin, which did. That gets rid of Ambrose. Then the Miz got pinned by Cena, pulling that feud. Future Feud.
Mm-hmm. Well, also, it's obviously going to set up Ambrose versus Corbin at some point.
Oh, yeah, for sure, yeah. That's going to be for the IC title, which Corbin will probably win.
Yep.
Yeah, which would be cool.
Yeah, it'd be awesome, yeah.
Will be. And then Bray Wyatt pinned Cena. Oh, snap. And then you pinned AJ Styles and won.
I think that was the way to do it.
Yeah.
Having Bray Wyatt pin Cena first, get rid of him early, because... I mean, we said on the podcast, didn't we? Because we played the elimination. Not sorry, on the podcast, on YouTube.
Live stream, yeah.
That we thought the last two would be Bray Wyatt and Cena.
Mm.
But I think it, you know, when you look back at it, it was the right thing to do to have AJ versus Bray Wyatt at the end.
Yeah, that's not a match you'd like to see any other time. Like two heels going at it.
Yeah,
and it was cool.
But the crowds were. I mean, AJ's a face. I don't care what anybody says. Pretty much. He is.
At this point, yeah.
And Bray Wyatt, super heel. Even, you know, regardless of the reaction he got on SmackDown.
Yeah.
The reaction he even got when he won the belt. But I think that was definitely the right thing to do. It baffles me why they felt like they had to put the belt on Cena for 2 weeks.
Yeah,
or less than that.
Yeah.
Really, well, it was 2 weeks, wasn't it? Yeah. When you could have just had AJ drop it and still... played out the story the way that it is doing currently. Just equal the record for the sake of equaling the record is baffling to me. It doesn't mean anything.
Because he could have had another two title reigns. He probably will have another two title reigns down the line.
I'm certain he will, but I'm almost certain that Ric Flair's had more than 16.
Well, yeah.
Just the TV will have you believe otherwise.
Yeah, maybe. But yeah, so it was a really good match. Rita told me a few years ago that in the early days of NXT that Husky Harris would pin John Cena and AJ Styles. I'd have called you a liar, but here we are.
Yeah, I'm very happy to see him with the belt. I mean, he definitely deserves it, 100%. We knew it was coming because obviously the rumours have been like that since the Royal Rumble.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Rumours everywhere.
So,
Where to win that. So, where to get a point. So ends in a draw yet again.
Yeah.
So, to the point of Edwards.
It was an okay show.
It was okay,
interesting results. Naomi going over Alexa. But Bray Wyatt is obviously the big talking point coming out of it.
I liked the Elimination Chamber match and Randy Orton vs. Luke Harper, I thought.
Yeah.
Two great matches.
For the Elimination Chamber match alone, it was great.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I agree. Yeah.
So, good stuff. So, we just did Monday Night Raw.
Yeah, skim through it.
Yeah, I'll skim through it. I don't know.
Because, you know what, I skipped through it. There was so much crap this week. There was some good...
There's some good stuff in there,
Some good talking points from Raw.
I thought it was better. I thought it was... It's been the best one for a while.
Yeah, I think so.
But that's not hard to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a bit of guff in there.
Yeah, I mean, I New skipped... Day again. I did skip... New Day stuff is terrible every week at the minute.
Oh, man.
Yeah, strange.
Yeah, what is happening with the New
Day? I know.
Yeah.
I know. Since they lost the belts, they almost sort of... They lost that momentum straight away.
Yeah. It's going to be floundering
around. It's like, shit, what do we do with them now?
Yeah.
Now what?
Yeah. Ice cream. Yes. so it started off tonight. The first match of the night was the club versus Roman Reigns, 2-on-1. Engine DQ when... well, it's called Gavin Anderson both beating up Roman at the same time. Not allowed. Naughty DQ. And then Roman Reigns got the upper hand because of course he does. And blah, blah, blah.
Lol, Roman wins.
Lol, Roman wins, pretty much.
I don't know. I think at the end, when Gallows and Anderson walked off, Reigns has got the chair, hasn't he? And if you look, he's like, he's holding his ribs and he's like, can barely stand. And I think, I don't know, it kind of made it, oh, okay, he's not this...
Okay. Well, I think
he's not this superhuman that wears body armour and has...
Yeah.
That's fair.
Has these gloves with brass knuckles in.
Talk to me about this when he beats Braun Strowman at WrestleMania. Oh, no, he's going to fight Undertaker, isn't he? He's going to beat Braun Strowman at Fastlane, and he's going to beat Undertaker at WrestleMania.
Yeah, and he's going to be... He's going to be the only guy that...
Known forever.
He's going to be the only guy that WWE will have you believe will be able to take the title off Brock when he eventually wins it. As well, they will, though, won't they?
That's the thing that's going to happen. Yeah.
Do you think what they'll do is they'll hit a complete reset when Finn Balor comes back? So they'll have Reigns as the champion, and then they'll have Balor beat Reigns again.
Yeah, because
completely hit reset. Then have that Kevin Owens versus Finn Balor feud that they were going to have, and just have next year or this year what last year was supposed to be.
Yeah, probably. Because you're not going to have Finn beat Brock, but anyway,
you wouldn't imagine.
You should.
So, I mean, yes, of course you should.
You absolutely should.
But I mean, he beat Reigns. No one thought he'd beat Reigns.
Yeah.
But what we have to remember here from a realistic standpoint, we know wrestling's fake, obviously.
Is it?
But yeah, apparently so.
Just wait.
Finn Balor's weighs less than 200 pounds?
Shrug.
Get him in the cruiserweights.
Yeah, get him
in the
cruiserweights.
Thank you, Balor.
So we had that awful New Day thing with Bo Dallas.
Bo Dallas again, back on the campaign trail.
Yeah, sure. Something about ice cream. Bo Dallas whips up the ice cream plans or something. I don't know. I don't know.
It's like CM Punk ice cream bars all over again.
Yeah, at least that was interesting and funny.
That's true.
It had a point to it. This just doesn't.
And it had a t-shirt as well.
And it did, yeah.
They roll it out.
That's true.
There's a Bootio's t-shirt. So.
That's true. There could be a New Day. What's it called, by the way, the ice cream? I skipped the bit.
I can't remember.
It must have had a stupid name. It must have.
I think it did.
Did it not?
It was just plans for blueberry ice cream, wasn't it?
I can't remember.
Next week it'll have a name.
For sure, yeah.
I read as well that, at the end, they poured the Bootio's cereal into Bo Dallas's mouth, didn't they?
Oh, yeah.
And someone said it's just a really terrible ass-to-mouth joke.
That's the thing.
Putting Bootio's in the opponent's mouth doesn't quite have the same effect as putting dollar bills in the opponent's mouth like the Million Dollar Man used to do.
So we had cruiserweight match, Gallagher versus Noam Dar. Great match, both guys are great. Still should have been longer.
Definitely longer, but both guys. See, this is a thing. The crowd don't care, but these guys are putting really good matches on.
Yeah
great. That matches. Said, they are getting behind Gallagher. I think it's because he's funny.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah.
He looks funny. He has a British accent.
And he has funny music.
He has funny music.
Funny to Americans.
Yeah.
But he's awesome, though.
He is.
It's great to see in that one segment, there's three guys from the UK.
Yeah.
Noam Dar, Neville, and Jack Gallagher. And it's like, okay. Yeah.
British wrestling. Good. Good stuff.
British wrestling.
Yeah. Clap.
So then Emelina debuted, I think. I've been waiting a long time for Emelina to debut, and now I'm going to be waiting a long time for her to go back to just regular Emma, I guess.
Should we just come out? Should we address the elephant in the room here and just say I was right?
Well, yeah, we were kind of right, weren't
we?
We both had the same thought.
We.
It's Sunny and Finn, Grains and Craft podcast. What? Sure.
Hashtag Sunny was right.
Hashtag
Finn nodded.
Yeah. Finn was also there.
I knew this was coming. You just saw it a mile off.
Weird way to do it.
So now, people didn't see it a mile off because people were like, okay, weird. But I said it not just last week, but I said it before.
Yeah.
That if and when she does debut as Emelina, they just won't go through with it. And I wanted her to debut as the wrestler that she should be.
Yeah.
And I think that's what they've realised. They've like, are we really going to waste this sort of gimmick on this caliber of women's wrestler?
Yeah.
They will use it at some point. I'm certain of it, they will. They'll use this slutty gimmick at some point down the line, but it wouldn't have worked for Emma.
Yeah.
And she's going to now be a great heel.
Do you think that's why it took so long for her to debut/not debut?
Well, I think they booked themselves into a corner with it. I think they sort of realised when she didn't debut the first time and they were like premiering next week, and then she didn't, and they just played the vignette again.
Yeah.
They were like, we're going to have a rethink here because this might not work. And now, obviously, they have had a change of heart in it. They obviously are now going back to Emma being the Emma that I think she was before, and she'll probably go back with Dana Brooke and they'll do that and that'll be fine.
Yeah, that'll be good.
And they'll do that again and I'm fine with it. But this wouldn't have worked, and it was I thought it was a shit gimmick anyway. It's great seeing Emma in a bikini and all that sort of stuff. But like we said last week, we're not gay, but we would rather her come back and be a good wrestler.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's the PG era.
It's different now.
You can't.
So different. I mean, it's not like when Tori Wilson and they're like, Goodwin had the Divas videos under his bed and all that sort of stuff. It's different.
The glory days.
Yeah. The glory hole days. And it's different.
Like before this, I was convinced that Emma was going to come down and interfere with the main event, Bayley versus Charlotte.
Right.
Because it made sense, because it's a women's tag team match, or women's title match at the main event. Emma's going to be re-debuting.
Well, yeah, you're right, it would have made perfect.
That would have been good. That didn't cross my mind, actually.
Just destroy Bayley and join up with Charlotte.
Yeah, I thought that would be cool. But
now I've got to go back to be Emma, and everyone's like, oh, okay. And then 2 hours later, sure. comes out.
Yeah. But nope, this is just
even,
a weird
even when
thing.
She came down, it looked like a weird segment.
It did. She sounded weird as well. She sounded really nervous, and she had this weird... It was almost like she was trying to put a British accent on.
She's Australian.
I know she is, but...
It sounded like she was trying to put
like,
on...
She just sounded weird as well.
She was never one for promos before, though.
Yeah.
So it's, it is a weird thing, but it's something that I'm glad is happening. Because Emma doesn't need to be Emelina, and it just sounds... Just outrageously ridiculous.
Yeah.
So now she'll go back to Emma. When she'll come back, I don't know.
Hopefully not another 16 weeks.
Yeah.
I'm sort of hoping it'll be next week.
Hopefully.
To be honest, and we get some answers.
Corey Graves is gutted.
Yeah, he is.
He's devastated, yeah.
every week.
Just go and fap over the pictures on Instagram with her. All those pictures are there.
Yeah. She's not deleted them.
Good to know.
I know.
But yeah, I called it.
Yeah. Sorry.
That's all I took away from Raw.
Good job.
Well done.
So after that, but a surprisingly not terrible Braun Strowman versus Mark Henry match.
Yeah,
Braun pretty much destroyed Mark Henry. The cool power stamp. It's cool. It's worth watching.
It was a good match considering.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, exactly.
It was a good match.
It was cool.
Braun Strowman did a drop kick.
He did, yeah. Fuck. This is like, craziness.
I like Mark Henry. I loved it when he had the world title that time. And
yeah,
it was genuinely believable because they made the character that way.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, well, you can't beat Mark Henry because he's bigger and stronger than you. And that's how he was. And he was world champion for ages, putting people in the Hall of Pain.
Yeah.
And it was awesome. But now I see Mark Henry, it's like when they had that bloody, what was it? Tussle in Texas or something.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that was weird.
There's like, they were like, it's the Tussle in Texas. Like, no one cares about this crap. It's 2016.
It's not a real thing. Go away.
Yeah. Stop making stuff up.
Yeah. It's a shame because Mark Henry is not really doing anything of worth anymore. He won't be released. He'll retire, obviously. Because
he's an ambassador, isn't he?
Absolutely. But they don't need for him to do garbage like this. He could...
believe putting over Braun Strowman is a pretty decent thing to be doing. He made it look strong.
I suppose.
Yeah.
It's Big Show next week, so.
Probably.
Big Show won't go over for him. No way. Not chiseled Big Show.
He's pretty chiseled.
He's ripped, isn't he?
Yeah.
He is, at the minute.
I don't think Big Show will go over.
Do you not?
I think they'll be. No, because they're building Big Show up for some massive match against Shaq at WrestleMania.
Great.
So they won't. It'll be a no contest next week. That's what it'll be.
Probably. Anyway, so we had a Samoa Joe interview. Samoa Joe now in the suits. Samoa Joe. Can't do it. cool interview with Michael Cole. Yeah, good stuff.
Amazing.
Yeah.
He's
great.
Best heel in WWE.
Yes, agreed.
I normally skip those segments when they have them interviews.
Me too. Yeah,
I think, nah.
Yeah, Samoa Joe's worth it.
But I watched that one.
Yeah.
And it was awesome.
Oh god, it's awesome. I put it on Twitter, but he's so good at playing the complete bastard.
He is, yeah.
He really is, and he's awesome.
Good stuff.
So happy that he's on the main roster.
Me too.
I see where they're going with this thing with Sammy, which obviously is what happened next. Sammy won his match against whoever he was. Who did he beat?
Rusev.
Yeah.
Handsome Rusev. It's a good match.
Handsome Rusev. <That's>, it was a good match, yeah.
Yeah.
And then obviously Samoa Joe came out and beat up Sammy. Samoa Joe would have fought Rollins at Fastlane.
Yeah.
Rollins isn't there. He'll now fight Sammy. I'm absolutely fine with
him. Yeah, that's a match I'd like to see, for sure.
And it'll be a good match.
Cause, oh, yeah, it'll be
definitely.
Quality.
Because Sammy always puts good matches under.
Yeah, and Joe's amazing, awesome.
Yeah.
Both great.
It's interesting hearing Joe talk about him not getting signed 17 years ago. WWE didn't want to sign him. I know why they didn't want to sign him, because he was fat. And that's exactly what it was. There's no beating around the bush. It's because of what he looked like, and WWE wasn't about that at that point. It was all people who looked like John Cena.
People
with a physique. Samoa Joe didn't have a physique. Yeah, Bobby Lashley, exactly.
He's fat.
And that's why Joe didn't get signed before, I'm certain of it.
Yeah, for sure.
Because he was a big guy. Now the landscape has changed.
Fat asses.
And you got Kevin Owens.
Fat asses.
And Joe, and people like that. So that's why he didn't get signed.
Yes, okay.
Because of fat asses.
also worth noting, Teddy Long is going to Hall of Fame.
I'm fine with it.
Yeah, cool.
Some of the music they played in that video package was fucking terrible. Like, oh, you love to have fun. There's some garbage music over the top of it. It's like, what is this? Just play his fucking entrance theme. Let him dance over that. But, you know, I like Teddy Long. Looks like he's always had a real hoot during his career.
Yeah, mm. Oh, Teddy. Good stuff.
Interesting, because a lot of people probably wouldn't know that he managed some of those tag teams.
Yeah. And I always think of him as the SmackDown general manager. But,
ref, then general manager. Ref,
yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah. Anyway, after the match, we had Tozawa. Okay, with Tozawa versus Daivari. Jesus. with Brian Kendrick on commentary. Tozawa is apparently Kendrick's, like, protege.
Sure.
That's the thing. That'll match at,
he can speak
Barclay.
Perfect English.
He can. Yeah. He can. I don't know what they're doing with that.
The crowd are getting into him, though.
Yeah.
Crowd are getting into him.
It's good stuff. To them.
Which Mustafa Ali won't come down with a turban on his head, though. Why do they insist on it?
Well, maybe it's his choice, I don't know. Who knows?
I doubt that very much.
Shrug.
I'm not sure. His entrance theme is called Magic Carpet Ride.
Is it? Oh, no, actually, I didn't know that.
I wish that was his entrance theme.
That'd be amazing.
Mustafa Ali comes down dressed like Aladdin.
Yeah.
The fez, little red fez on his head. That'd be awesome.
What's the monkey?
Yeah, Aladdin wears a fez as well, doesn't he?
No.
Yeah, he does.
Like a fantasy.
Does he?
Yeah, he does.
Okay, I think we're
over it.
So we had
Twitter. Does Aladdin wear a fez?
So we had probably the highlight of the night. The festival of friendship.
Yeah, he's got a fez on, look.
So he does.
Oh, fair top play. Fez.
That's Mustafa Ali's next gimmick, I'm pitching it.
So the festival of friendship with Chris Jericho and Kevin Owens. Hilarious. Very funny.
Yeah, it was good.
I think it was really good.
Very good, good. The creation of Kevin picture was amazing.
Yeah.
Goldberg made a return.
See, Goldberg wrote morons on Twitter.
Yeah, and then Kevin Owens replied.
Yeah.
Yeah, that a bit of a feud, didn't there?
Yeah.
I think it's absolute kayfabe.
Oh, yeah. Back and forth on Twitter. It was pretty funny.
Headbutt at locker. nothing to talk about.
Goldberg will be laughing when he wins that championship in 2.5 minutes.
No.
Less than that.
We don't want it. So anyway, Kevin Owens gave Chris Jericho the list of KO. What?
You'll hear it on the podcast.
Okay. Sure. Kevin Owens beat up Jericho. Sadness.
Yes, but it was the path it was always going to take.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I thought it was good storytelling because I actually did felt quite bad with Jericho.
Yes, I did.
Even though I know it's obviously gen wrestling, fake stuff.
And the commentary sort of made it out like now Jericho's the face and it looked like the Kevin Owens mold, you know, like when he's like taking in a deep breath after he's beaten the living crap out of somebody.
Yeah.
And I thought it was very, very good. Like when he why is my name on the list and then
That was very cool.
I thought it was very, very good. And I think they'll have an excellent match at WrestleMania as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was cool.
Made Kevin Owens look like a massive heel.
It was a lot like the when Kevin Owens turned on Sammy.
Yeah.
In NXT. It was very much that, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then,
what's cool is people genuinely cared.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, you know, yes, you saw it coming, and it's been coming probably for weeks, but it didn't make it any less of a good segment.
Yeah,
no, I thought it was really good.
Very, very good.
Even though it was that long that it had a break in between.
Oh, God, yeah.
As well.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Good joke. Very funny.
It's funny at the start when he's...
His dancing was amazing.
When he's dancing as he's walking out. Fantastic. Absolutely superb.
Good stuff. So we had a very short match. Cesaro versus Enzo Amore. For some reason, Cesaro knocked him out with a big uppercut.
Great.
End of match.
Stay down.
Yes, don't go back up. And then we had the main event, of course, which was Charlotte versus Bayley. And it was very good. Good match. Not sure why they gave Bayley the championship now. Please stop bouncing the title around. Makes no sense.
This is to maintain Charlotte's impeccable pay-per-view record.
Yeah, I've been voted on there.
She'll win it back.
Yeah, I look forward to winning at Fastlane and becoming 27-time champion.
Yeah. Now, does she still lose it at WrestleMania? Because I've been convinced for weeks that Bayley was actually going to win it at WrestleMania. So when she won it on Raw, I was like, okay, now I don't understand it. Now I thought about it, it's like, well, okay, so Charlotte hasn't lost on pay-per-view in whatever. WWE love that shit. So she'll win it at Fastlane. Now, do they take it off her again at WrestleMania?
I think so. I think Bayley gets her WrestleMania moment.
You think she does?
Yeah.
I think Sasha wins it.
I mean, it's like, why ever win it now?
Sasha's
going to win it.
I've changed my tune now, yeah.
Triple threat?
No, it'd be a four-way. They'll get Nia in there.
Oh, of course, yeah.
But I think Sasha and Charlotte had a little thing before the match, and Sasha was...
she interfered.
She interfered, basically.
Yeah. Is the knee injury kayfabe? Or is it...
I think so.
Don't know. Yeah, I guess so.
You never know with Sasha.
I know.
Well, yeah,
it's a I think she turns heel, to be honest. I think she beats Bayley up.
Mm-hmm. Could happen. There's rumours going around that she might turn heel.
Yeah, I think she turns heel, and I think she wins it. So I think she maybe walks away with the belt at WrestleMania. Give Sasha her WrestleMania moment.
It's another title change, isn't it? Because we're thinking it's going to change at Fastlane to keep up this record.
It's dumb.
And then we think it'll change at WrestleMania. So that's another two changes.
Yeah, it is.
It's crazy.
WrestleMania obviously is the start of a new season.
Yeah, it's a reset, isn't it?
But the fact there's been so many title changes in the current season, in quotes, it's outrageous. The amount of times the women's championship has changed hands.
It's not just that. I mean, all the championships.
Yes, Cruiserweight title's been bounced around.
Viz tweeted, didn't he? Did you see that?
I didn't see it.
It was something like there's been, in the last 24 weeks of wrestling, there's been quite a big number of title changes.
Mm-hmm.
It might have even been 22 title changes in the last 24 weeks of programming.
It makes it less special.
It does. Okay.
Because you have, you know, the women's title is the main championship for the women, of course. So that's their world title.
Yeah, exactly.
So it'd be like the world title changing hands every other pay-per-view.
Yeah, which is kind of happening. On SmackDown. But, yeah. I don't know. It's weird. But, yeah, I'll just wait until WrestleMania to have a win it there. To have it now on Raw. But, whatever. It's a cool moment for Bayley. It's a cool match. And,
Get me wrong. I was so happy for her when she won it. And it was an amazing moment when she did.
Yeah.
But it's just baffling.
It is. I agree.
Truly baffling. It's not even sort of like, okay, well, now what? It is now what happens?
Yeah, it's weird. Ben.
Here we go.
Oh, you got it.
So, yeah. So, so this was the day after she won it on Raw, didn't she?
Yeah.
So this was yesterday. So that Bayley win last night was the 28th new main roster title change since August 2016, 28 in 30 weeks.
Well,
wow.
That's a lot.
Are you going for the Trent 7 look at the minute, by the way?
Mustache
Mountain.
Not on purpose, no. I mean, last week my beard was ridiculous. So
you trimmed it up a bit and shaped it. And
Well, I haven't.
Now you're now you're from Mustache Mountain.
Yeah.
I'll take that.
I like Trent 7. I can't wait for that match on NXT this week.
Yeah, that's going to be amazing.
Yeah.
Yes, I forgot about that.
Mm. Very, very cool. Since SmackDown happened, I blasted it very quickly today. Didn't have time to make notes.
Sure, I watched 12 minutes of it, so let's go. I know what happened, because Facebook is just full of videos from WWE every single morning.
Oh, yeah, of course, yeah. Main event was excellent. I did watch that. That was really, really good. Check that out. It was Triple Threat, Bray Wyatt versus John Cena versus AJ Styles for the WWE Championship. Excellent. Go watch it.
Very cool. Actually, Luke Harper attacked Bray Wyatt prior to the match. It's great to see Bray Wyatt being booked so strong.
Yes, very cool.
Be interesting to see. I don't care what the storyline is at the minute. I'm adamant that it'll be Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Because I know that obviously on SmackDown, Randy Orton said, as long as you're the leader, I'll always be the follower, or words to that effect.
Yeah.
So I won't fight you at WrestleMania. So Daniel Bryan in turn then announced a battle royal for next week's SmackDown to determine the number one contender at WrestleMania.
Oh, yeah.
And I fully expect Randy Orton to win that as well.
Probably. Would he want to be the match, though? Maybe to stop everyone else to win?
He'll turn on him. This coming. There's no way it's not coming.
Yeah. It makes too much sense.
It's never been a long-term thing, has it?
Is it because... Do you think WWE are doing this because we've known since the Royal Rumble what the main event at WrestleMania is going to be?
Trying to throw us off, yeah. Maybe.
Trying to throw us off. That's why they've probably had... a lot of rumours going around about the women's match. That's why they've had Bayley winning. Maybe that's what they're trying to do.
Yeah.
Trying to throw people off the scent, but ultimately
there's a fast lane, some of the least like the card of fast lane, which had Sami Zayn versus Chris Jericho for the US title on it. With now that Chris Jericho's like presumably going to be out of fast lane because he's got beaten up by Kevin Owens.
It's in 3 weeks.
Yeah. But apparently that match isn't going to happen, but they left it up anyway to throw people off. That was a room anyway.
Okay.
So, yeah. Who knows?
Maybe that's what they're trying to do because, I mean, people have leaked that information. I mean, Goldberg, we knew that he was going to challenge Owens fast lane.
Yeah.
We knew that Bray was going to win the Elimination Chamber. The internet's there to ruin wrestling, basically. I won't be looking at the betting odds for WrestleMania this year.
No, I'm not going to.
I think that's probably the reason we maybe didn't enjoy WrestleMania as much last year because we knew what was going to happen.
Yeah.
It was 7 hours long as well.
Yeah, it was
5 hours long, yeah.
So what was outside? So there's a rumour at Fastlane that it's going to be Jericho versus Sami Zayn.
That's the initial rumour, but now Sami Zayn's looking to go against Samoa Joe and Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho probably going to be into doing the thing. So it's like... Yeah. But they didn't take down the video that had the thing on it. So it's like, are they trying to throw us off on purpose? Are they trying to get smart?
Yeah.
Which would be a good thing because I don't know what's going to happen. I'll just pause it.
Well, then they need to stop this information leaking is what needs to happen.
Yeah.
It's like the, there's rumours that it's going to be Cena Nikki versus Ms. Maryse.
Yeah.
And you think, nah, surely not. And then during Elimination Chamber,
yeah.
Maryse gets...
Covered in makeup
because of a brawl between Nikki and Natalya, and you think, oh, there you go, that set that up.
Yeah.
So how does it get out? And
yeah.
I guess now it's just easier for one person. So you get someone like Meltzer gets that information, you can just tweet it.
Yeah. Yes.
Straight away it's out there.
Exactly.
You know, before it would have been a lot harder, you know. You'd have been on teletext looking.
Yeah. Well, exactly, but it's like, there's no reaction to it either. You know what I mean? It's like, people don't see it and change it. They're just like, well, people know now. I guess that's just it.
Yeah.
And like, if they are trying to throw us off, I'm certain it's going to be Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt. I can't see it any other way.
Yeah.
What does Randy Orton do otherwise?
Yeah, or why have him win the Rumble?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Why win the Royal Rumble?
But it's cool to have like red herrings out there just be like, could this happen? Could this be something else? Could they change it and do this? So, I don't know.
And obviously, this age of social media and rumours getting around and them spreading fast,
yeah.
It's something that potentially WWE is still trying to work out, okay, these things get out because of, you know, we're a massive company and you've probably got disgruntled people that think, well, fuck you, I'm going to ruin your next 6 months worth of programming. I'm going to go on the internet and put it on Reddit and whatever. And WWE are probably still trying to learn, okay, how do we react to that?
Yeah,
in this modern world. So what do we do? Do we throw these red herrings in there? Do we just go with the flow and go, oh, it's out there now. Let's do it.
Well, maybe, you know, tell people other information.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, wrong information.
Give them wrong information.
Yeah, see how it gets out.
Yeah. Oh, we're going to have Jericho versus Owens for the championship at Fastlane. And then it doesn't happen and Goldberg is challenging for the title. Mm. Right.
Yeah.
There has to be a way to stop this information getting out because it's just fucking ridiculous.
It is.
It's stupid.
It is.
I don't know. It's. I'm excited for WrestleMania, but I'm excited beyond WrestleMania. I mean, I am every year because I want to believe that they'll get it right.
They've got 1 year, right?
Absolutely. I mean, I was thinking about this on the way over here. With, you know, we're how many weeks away from WrestleMania?
Six, ten, twelve.
That number. But even with a pay-per-view in between, we pretty much know what the card's going to be. And some of those matches, we know what the outcome is likely going to be.
Yeah.
So we think we know, this is classic, we do this, and then WWE just throw something in.
Yeah. Which, by the way, I'm happy for.
Which is great. Yeah. But we know that it's going to, we think we know that Goldberg is going to beat Owens, and then it's going to be Brock versus Goldberg.
And then Jericho versus Owens.
Yeah. And, okay, that one isn't obvious who's going to win that. Probably going to be Owens, because I'm pretty sure Fozzy are bringing an album out this year.
Yep.
So Jericho's going to go off and do that.
Fozzy are playing Download, so that pretty much tells you.
Exactly, so there you go.
Yeah.
And we know that Goldberg isn't going to stick around for a title run.
No.
No.
So even if it's just for two pay-per-views, he wouldn't do it. So they're going to give the title to Brock. We know that. But then Brock's just going to be a part-time champion again. We know Big Show and Shaq, and we know that he's potentially Miz Cena thing.
And obviously, if indeed it is going to be Roman Reigns versus Undertaker, you fully expect Reigns to beat Strowman at Fastlane. Otherwise, surely it would be Strowman versus Undertaker.
Yeah,
because that would much more of a challenge for Undertaker. You know, it's just all these things. I mean, we could, you know, I could sit here and I could talk about this for another hour, but we're approaching 2 hours now. So, you know, let's mix it up this week. If you give Steve the encyclopedia, he can read from it, and I'm going to pick the letter.
Okay. You are Steve.
Steve, do you want to do the want to do the honour of doing the jingle?
No.
Just trying to think what it is now.
Come on, guys. This week's episode of
the Sunny Vin Games and Graps podcast. Sunny Vin's Game and Grab podcast is what I'm going to say.
Mm-hmm. I'll do it. This week's episode of the Games and Graps podcast is brought to you by the letter B.
Ooh. B. Okay,
no,
let's have a look.
Who knows,
Martino? Finn does this podcast every single week and doesn't know the jingle.
No, I didn't. I listened to what you meant. I thought you were going to do it and then I didn't mind. Whatever.
Finn.
Whatever.
Don't give me your excuses.
Okay, let's have a look.
Brett of the Hitman Heart.
Never heard of him.
Mystery.
Okay, he might be one.
Richard's Bulldog.
Briscoe Brothers. The Brian Kendrick.
Ooh.
The Brood.
The Brood, yeah.
Some bloke called Brock Lesnar.
Who?
The Brooklyn Brawler. Brooke. Sure, it's pretty hard.
Brood is the bar of beefcake.
I'm going to go back to Bracchus.
Okay.
Am I pronouncing that properly?
Bracchus?
Bracchus?
Okay. Yeah, I think so.
Bracchus? Question mark?
I'm Ron Burgundy.
I'm Brackus. Okay. Height, 6 foot. Weight, 275 pounds. From Germany.
Yeah.
Just Germany.
Germany. Not Berlin, Germany. Or...
At this point, WWE probably didn't know anywhere in Germany. Yeah. Just no, Germany. Well, just actually Germany.
Yeah.
Signature move, power slam. Mm,
that's original. Was he a big guy?
He's a muscly fella. Yeah. He looks more like a Chippendale than he does a wrestler.
I've been into that back in the day.
That's what I've been told a lot as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get that a lot. Yeah. Okay, this powerhouse and former professional bodybuilder.
No,
yeah.
Standard.
Came to WWE in 1996.
Oh, that is classic as well.
Bracchus, which I'm presuming is how it's pronounced, was a relentless rule breaker and wanted not to just beat his opponents, but break them in half. He met superstars like Dr. X, The Sultan, Rockabilly, The Jackal, and Jeff Jarrett.
Well, this is WWF in the mid-90s, by the way. Yes. Terrible.
Yeah.
Yeah, awful.
In February 1998, he appeared at ECW's CyberSlam and fought Taz for the ECW television title.
It's Taz.
Right.
Later that year, he competed in the Brawl for All tournament, losing in disappointing fashion to Savio Vega.
It is disappointing.
But hang on, Brawl for All was like not fake either. Like they oh, yeah, like, that was that boxing tournament that WWE had, which is stupid fucking idea.
Yeah.
And if this guy's lost to
he lost to Savio Vega. Yeah.
He should have that now. Sin Cara would win.
Yeah, for sure.
After the loss, Bracchus returned to Europe and has not been seen since the WWE.
Yeah, I wonder why.
This week's Games and Graps podcast has been brought to you by the letter B.
Yes!
Yay!
Go subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. Go follow us on SoundCloud. And you can pretty much listen to the podcast anywhere you like, including your Xbox One.
Anywhere.
Go to youtube.com/ Sonny Finn Play and subscribe there. You can hear the podcast there and you can check out our WWE 2K17 streams. Follow Daydreamer Gaming on Twitter. Follow the Games and Graps podcast on Twitter @ Games and Graps. Like Cox and Dicks. Games and Graps. Daydreamer Gaming's @ Daydreamer Gaming. You can also go to YouTube and subscribe to Daydreamer on there. And yeah, all that good stuff. Like, subscribe, share. Leave us a nice comment and just be nice to us.
Yes.
Please. But for now, thank you very much for listening. This has been the Games and Graps podcast, episode 51. We are a weekly video game and wrestling podcast that posts every single Friday, nearly.
Mostly time.
Across podcast services, everywhere.
Everywhere.
I'm Sunny.
I'm Vin.
I'm Podkins.
Yeah.
And we will speak to you next time. Thank you very much for listening, guys. Take it easy. Goodbye.
Thank you much. Goodbye.
Biscuits and gravy.